Last week, we reported that Lyft plans to lay off possibly more than 1,200 workers after already eliminating 700 roles last year. The company said it would announce more details about the cuts tomorrow. This move comes days after a new CEO officially took over, and as the ride-hailing company struggles to keep up with its rival, Uber. So, what's going on with Lyft? Joining me to talk about this is WSJ ride-hailing reporter Preetika Rana. Preetika, can you start by telling us what we know about these cuts? Who's going to be affected, and why is Lyft making them?
So we reported on Friday that the company was planning to make another big round of cuts. Lyft issued a statement in response to our story, acknowledging that something is coming, but that it didn't say what. All that the company told employees was that they could expect to know more on Thursday, meaning tomorrow. Our reporting indicates it's going to be big. 30% or more of staff is what I'm hearing from my sources.
So this comes as Lyft's new CEO is just stepping into the role. Let's talk about this change of leadership. Can you start by telling us, you know, why did Lyft's founders step down?
So the company has really been struggling for the last year. Its stock price is down over 70%. Morale has been hard hit at the company as it's been losing market share to Uber. So employees were saying, look, the co-founders have done a good job of transforming a scrappy startup into a household name, but are they really ready to take this to the next level, to lead a large public company? And that led to a lot of dissatisfaction. Employees were asking the co-founders about this at all hands meetings. And a lot of this also got to Lyft's board, and there was increasing concern among investors about the future of the company. So late last month, both the company's co-founders stepped back. They continue to remain on the company's board, but they said maybe it's time for new leadership. And Lyft has a new CEO who officially took over last week.
So tell us a bit about him. Who is he and what's his vision for Lyft?
Yeah, so Lyft's new CEO, David Risher, actually served on the company's board for the last 20 years. He has actually run his own nonprofit. But before that, he held senior leadership roles at Microsoft and at Amazon. And at Amazon, I'm told that he was very close to Jeff Bezos and that people who did work with him at the time enjoyed working with him. It is an interesting choice, given that he comes from the nonprofit world. I have met him. I have spoken to him since he got the top job, and he wouldn't give us details, but he says that his vision is to really reinvent the way that Lyft treats its riders, the way that Lyft also treats its drivers. So he's going for a complete overhaul. What that involves remains to be seen, but he says he certainly has plans to shake things up.
What's morale at the company like now, given that they've gotten this leadership change, but also that these big cuts are coming?
I think it's really mixed. So on one hand, Lyft has really struggled over the last year. Morale hasn't been good anyway. A lot of senior leaders at Lyft have departed. And now there's added anxiety about whether they would have jobs with these big cuts. But on the other hand, there's also a sense of optimism and excitement among some employees, given the new leadership. Some of them felt frustrated that things were just moving very slowly or barely moving at all under the co-founders. So there's a sense that, okay, here's some fresh blood, and maybe things could take a turn for the better.
What about investors? What are they making of all these changes?
The market has responded positively to the change in leadership. So when the co-founders announced that they were stepping down, the stock actually went up. Similarly, when we broke the story about more cuts coming at Lyft, the stock also jumped.
Preetika, can you explain to us why Lyft is struggling so much to keep up with Uber?
So one of the things was that Lyft decided not to diversify into any other businesses during the pandemic. Uber, of course, had a food delivery business. Now, that wasn't a decision it took during the pandemic, but that decision paid off in a big way. That said, Lyft decided that it didn't want to diversify during the health crisis, so it stuck with its transportation routes. Even then, A lot of people say, well, if they did stick their guns to transportation, they should have owned that space. That didn't happen. And then one of the other things was, and again, this predates to the pandemic, but Uber has a global business. Lyft limited its presence to North America. Uber benefited in a big way having global operations at a time when the US was going through multiple lockdowns. And when the co-founder stepped down, one of the co-founders said to me, I asked him, is there something you regret? And he says, yeah, the decision not to take Lyft global is something I regret.
Pritika, I wonder, as somebody who covers this space, what is it going to mean if Lyft can't keep up with Uber and Uber's growth? What is it going to mean for US consumers and for competition in the ride-hailing space?
Already, as Lyft stock has tanked over 70% over the last year, there's been a lot of speculation. Does someone buy Lyft? Does the company become so irrelevant that you only have one player in the market? And this is something I asked the new CEO as well. Do you plan to sell the company eventually if perhaps things don't work out? And he says for now, he doesn't have any plans to sell the company. His plan is really to get back in the game. He acknowledges that they are a distant number two in the market. And he says, the place that I want Lyft to be, for starters, is a strong number two, because I don't want to have one player. He called it a 500-pound gorilla. That's how he referred to Uber as. He said, I don't think it's good for a 500-pound player to dominate the entire market, because choice is good, competition is good, it helps everybody.
Okay, that's WSJ's Pritika Rana, who covers ride-hailing. Thanks for joining us, Pritika.
Only college you go to with a GED is community college. You know why they call it community college? Because anybody in the community can go and crack a head pop if you duck there. Come on in. Community college is like a disco with books. Here's $10, I'm gonna get my learn on.
One of the selling points of attending community college is that it offers an affordable pathway to a four-year degree. But the reality is often different. From our higher ed desk, GBH's Kirk Carapazzo reports many four-year colleges accept few, if any, credits from two-year schools.
To get a head start on his bachelor's degree while still in high school, William Kamani took courses at a nearby community college in Brockton.
I didn't really know what I was getting into.
A stellar student, the 19-year-old son of Kenyan immigrants earned enough credits to graduate not only with a high school diploma, but an associate degree. When he enrolled at the University of Chicago, though, he learned a hard lesson in college economics. None of his community college credits would count toward his degree.
Zero.
Were you surprised?
Part of me expected it, because institutions like the University of Chicago are very anti-transfer credit. But getting the email saying that none of them were going to get transferred was quite painful.
Nearly all community college students are like Kamani. They hope to transfer their credits and earn a bachelor's degree. But historically, very few of them realize that goal. Only one in six ever succeed.
They get discouraged or sort of fall off the pathway before they ever get to their bachelor's college.
That's Martin Kurzweil with the nonprofit research group Ithaca SNR. He says part of the problem is that transfer students don't know how the credits they've earned at community college will count towards their bachelor's degree.
And because they don't know, they can't really plan for it. They end up taking things that don't count.
The Government Accountability Office finds about 43% of all college credits don't end up transferring and counting towards a new degree. And that shortchanges students, costing them thousands of dollars and preventing them from being able to graduate on time and with less debt.
Colleges are businesses. They need to survive.
Francesca Purcell lectures at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. She points out if schools require students to take more courses or repeat them, it boosts their bottom lines.
There's a big incentive to accept students. There is not a big incentive to accept all of their credits.
Why not?
Given the financial situation that most four-year institutions are in, that is not an unreasonable potential revenue source to overlook.
And colleges' revenue priorities come at the expense of mostly low-income students. Students like Simba Gandhari, who worked two jobs while earning his degree to support not only himself, but his family in Zimbabwe.
It was highly important for all of my credits to transfer because I needed to graduate within 2 years.
Gandhari transferred from a technical college in South Carolina to Cardinal Stritch University outside Milwaukee, hoping to graduate with less debt. At first, administrators agreed to accept all of his credits. Then, just as he had finished the credits required for a bachelor's degree, his academic advisor told him he still needed one more English class to graduate. That meant paying for another semester.
I was trying to figure out how would I even be able to extend another semester and pay for it and have the time to do it.
In the end, the college accepted his technical school English credit, but only after he emailed the college's president directly and pled his case.
It started to feel as if I was just another body and another way to make tuition.
Back in Chicago, William Kamani says the fact that four-year colleges frequently don't accept community college credits but recognize high school advanced placement courses exposes them as businesses catering to wealthier students. Research finds Black and Indigenous students have unequal access to AP coursework.
I think it kind of shows ingrained inequality, preferences towards, you know, suburban, more affluent students.
And he says it shows where college's priorities really are. In Boston, Kirk Carapezza, GBH 89.7.
This story was edited by Meg Woolhouse. It was made possible with support from Lumina Foundation. You're listening to GBH News.
No, you know, no. They're not products of their environments either. That's crap. Minorities don't give two shits about this country. They come here to exploit it, not to embrace it.
What does this have to
do? I mean, millions of white European Americans came here and flourished, you know, within a generation. So what the fuck is the matter with these people? They have to go around shooting at firemen.
What does this have to do with the murder of your father?
Because my father was murdered doing his job, putting out a fire in a fucking nigger neighborhood he shouldn't have even given a shit about. He got shot by a fucking drug dealer who probably still collects a welfare check.
One North Jersey town known for touting itself as a progressive community is being sued over accusations of discrimination. Two Black firefighters in Montclair are suing the township, several officials, and a test prep vendor, alleging the fire department's promotion process favors white firefighters. The lawsuit, which was first reported by Montclair Local and BaristaNet, contends Black firefighters faced, quote, egregious race discrimination in the process because, among other items, it was reworked to diminish the value of seniority, which the suit alleges would have favored Black members of the department, added a subjective job performance evaluation, and conspired with a test prep company to offer services for promotional exams to white firefighters only. The suit is seeking a jury trial and unspecified compensation for damages.
This is the familiar sound that signals an emergency response. Today, it's just for fun, and the kids visiting this Ventura County Fire Station are getting a chance to see what it's like to be a firefighter in our community.
We run about 2,000 calls a year out of here.
From a six-year-old dressing up in oversized firefighter's gear.
He's our new recruit. And the first thing he has to do is put on some crazy pants. All right, Elsie, let's get this helmet on you. Is that tight? Okay, so who wants to squirt water?
Every kid getting a chance to turn on the giant hose they use to fight fires.
There you go. Go for it.
Showing them around is David Schwab.
If you want to close it, push it down.
The Ventura County Fire Department fire captain at Station 36A shift. He spent 24 years in the fire service. He says this is an opportunity to demonstrate that they aren't all about just fighting fires.
Any reason that someone calls 911, we go. I mean, for the exceptionally sad and traumatic things to things that are kind of fun. We all love the fun stuff more, but we're not all about just fires. We're about being members of the community.
And while spraying water and sounding sirens might be the most dramatic and fun parts.
Good job. How was that?
Powerful. Schwab also shows the side of the job that not many people see.
All right, so we're going to go take a look at our kitchen and all of our bedrooms. And if you guys lead the way, we're just going to go towards the hallway. You can be at work for 72 hours, 96 hours. Can be sometimes tough, yeah.
This community was badly burned in the Woolsey wildfire in October 2018, and these youngsters are growing up with the risk of wildfires increasing.
No difference between a fire truck or a fire engine.
And while this is an opportunity for excitement, it's also a chance to educate them.
Fire engines have water, fire trucks don't. Most of our trucks do not have water. They have to be followed with the fire engine. We always plan for the most dynamic and significant fire season. We have a lot of grass growth this year, which means that we're going to have a lot of easy starts of fire. I don't know if fires will be established and be huge, but we could have a lot of fires. And so it could be just as extensive, just as significant, and we treat it as such. And so every year is difficult.
These kids and their parents appreciate the opportunity to see behind the scenes and meet the first responders in a non-emergency situation.
Today I was playing with a fire truck.
We have this great opportunity to come check out the local fire station and check out the truck and the water, and the kids all have fun, and I think the local firemen actually like it too.
It's just so nice that they can get hands-on experience what the firefighters do and get to learn a little bit more about that role in our community.
The kids think it's the coolest thing. I know my son, he's obsessed with fire trucks. His favorite thing to do is climb fire trucks and look at them, and so this was a really big deal for him. It's nice to learn more about all the different things that the firefighters and the fire department do and how engaged they are with the community.
And they might just be the firefighters of tomorrow. In Oak Park, Caroline Faraday, KCLU News.
Now to the second high-profile news anchor fired. Don Lemon is out at CNN after a series of on- and off-air controversies. Errol Reshef here with the story. Good morning, Errol.
Good morning to you. George Lemon had been with the network for nearly two decades and hosted his own primetime show for 8 years. He was on the air on Monday morning before tweeting the news of his firing, saying he was blindsided.
This morning, Don Lemon's former co-workers speaking out about his departure from CNN.
Don was a big part of this show over the last 6 months. He was one of the first anchors on CNN to have me on his show. That's something I'll obviously never forget. I agree with Chris. We wish him the best.
The CNN This Morning anchor signing off his show Monday, just hours later tweeting, "I was informed this morning by my agent that I have been terminated by CNN." Adding, "I would have thought that someone in management would have had the decency to tell me directly. I am stunned." CNN then with a tweet of its own, refuting Lemon's account, calling it inaccurate, writing, "He was offered an opportunity to meet with management, but instead released a statement on Twitter." The back and forth coming months after, Lemon made this on-air gaffe about women while discussing Nikki Haley's run for president, prompting his brief suspension.
Nikki Haley isn't in her prime. Sorry. When a woman is considered to be in her prime in her 20s and 30s and maybe 40s.
What are you talking? Wait.
That's not according to me.
Prime for what?
His co-anchors, Poppy Harlow and Caitlin Collins, appearing stunned, pushing back.
Are you talking about prime for, like, childbearing? Or are you talking about prime for being president?
What the facts are, Google it.
At the time, Chris Licht, CNN's chairman and CEO, sending a memo calling the comments unacceptable and mandating Lemon participate in formal training sessions. Lemon later telling staff, "When I make a mistake, I own it. And I own this one as well." On Monday, amid news of Lemon's departure, Haley tweeting, "To women everywhere, don't ever let anyone tell you you're past your prime." That instance, not the first time the firebrand host has raised eyebrows.
Is it fair to say this? Because I'm not a mommy, but is it mommy brain? Is it you?
No.
Variety also reporting recently allegations of past workplace misogyny by Lemon, citing more than a dozen unnamed current and former colleagues, claims Lemon denies.
And CNN offering no specific reason for Lemon's firing, but in an email to staff, Licht thanked Lemon for his contributions, writing, "Don will forever be a part of the CNN family," adding, "We wish him well and we will be cheering him on in his future endeavors." Guys.
Okay, Ariel, thanks very much.
Offensive messages Tucker Carlson sent showing contempt for Fox News management and colleagues were a major factor in the company's decision to oust him Monday, according to people familiar with the matter. The move took Carlson off the air, a shock to the host and his large audience, making the previous Friday's show his last.
And we'll be back on Monday. In the meantime, have the best weekend with the ones that you love, and we'll see you then.
Culturally, it's a big deal because Tucker Carlson was one of the most well-known TV personalities and the highest-rated primetime host.
Here's a look at the private messages that led to Carlson's surprise ouster and what's next to the former host and the network. Ahead of Fox's defamation trial against Dominion voting systems, people familiar with the matter say Fox News lawyers presented Carlson with what they thought was good news. They told him the court would redact from a legal filing the time he called a senior Fox News executive the C-word. But Carlson wasn't impressed. He told his colleagues he wanted the world to know what he said about the executive.
Internal messages, many of which were from Tucker Carlson to other colleagues, were made public in the discovery process, and some of those ended up being redacted, but in them, Mr. Carlson made disparaging remarks about some of his colleagues and other people at the network.
The court filings also revealed an exchange where Carlson called for the firing of a Fox News reporter for fact-checking Donald Trump's false claims about the 2020 election. "Please get her fired," Carlson wrote. "It's measurably hurting the company." In another message, Carlson is shown complaining about the network's news coverage, including its decision to call Arizona for Joe Biden on election night. According to one document, he wrote, "We devote our lives to building an audience, and they let Chris Wallace and Leland Vittert wreck it," and included an obscenity. In the messages, Carlson also made disparaging comments about on-air guests and former President Donald Trump. He wrote in a January 2021 text message that he was very close to being able to ignore Trump most nights, and that "I hate him passionately." Although many portions of the Dominion court documents are redacted, there was concern among Fox executives that if the redacted material were to become public, it would lead to further embarrassment for the network and the parent company. And on Monday, the network said it would part ways with the popular host.
Tucker found out about 10 minutes before it was announced by the company.
Fox News Media and Tucker Carlson have mutually agreed to part ways.
Carlson declined to comment on his departure. Within Fox, people familiar with the matter said reservations had been mounting about risks Carlson presented for the network. Landing blue-chip advertisers for his show was an issue.
Fox struggled with getting advertisers at 8 p.m. on Tucker's show, partially because of controversial heat remarks he made on a number of different topics.
His commentary had grown more extreme and expanded beyond a conservative viewpoint on politics.
"Female athletes are losing NCAA championships to men dressing up as women in order to cheat their way to victory. Democrats hate the police because they don't control the police. Very simple. So what is equity? Well, tonight, finally, we know what it is. Equity, it turns out, is racism."
Carlson trafficked in what critics and even some higher-ups within Fox felt was thinly veiled racism, such as this recent show where he's talking about one of the Tennessee lawmakers protesting for stricter gun control.
"Justin Pearson wasn't white. That's probably how he got into Bowdoin in the first place. But he did a fantastic impression of it. What a nice young man. Has he considered the apprenticeship program at Citibank?"
The former host is also a defendant in a separate lawsuit that was filed last month by Abby Grossberg, a former producer for Carlson.
"I was hoping that it would be more professional, and what he was portraying on air was just a show, and unfortunately that wasn't the case."
The Abby Grossberg lawsuit against Fox, and Tucker is also named as a defendant in that suit, describes a culture of misogyny and religious discrimination at the network.
Carlson had no comment on the lawsuit. Fox at the time said it hired independent outside counsel to investigate the concerns raised by Grossberg. Fox and News Corp, the parent company of the Wall Street Journal's publisher, share common ownership. Carlson, now off the air, has declined to comment on his future plans.
Some people have speculated that he might take on a career in politics. Some people have talked about, you know, him launching his own media venture of some sort or joining another network, but he hasn't commented on what he's going to do next.
For Fox News, his ouster leaves a primetime hole. The network is currently relying on a rotation of hosts until it names a permanent anchor for the 8 p.m. slot.
Historically, when anchors have left Fox, the network has survived. There are a number of examples of really prominent people who have left the network and launched their own careers. Megyn Kelly, Bill O'Reilly, Glenn Beck. But Fox nonetheless has found talent to replace them.
New details about Anthony Edwards tonight. Police say the Minnesota Timberwolves star was out of bounds after last night's playoff loss.
But he didn't get a technical foul or a fine. He got charged with assault. Mike Max is here right now with some new video of what happened. Maxie?
Yeah, more could come in terms of a fine later, but I doubt it. Yeah, they had a teammate punch a player punch a wall, and now this. This did not surface until late this afternoon. Anthony Edwards exits the floor after a Game 5 loss to Denver last night, ending the Wolves' season. This is the best I've seen of the incident, an angle of him throwing a chair as he leaves the floor. He's been charged with a third-degree misdemeanor assault for the chair coming in contact with two working security people. A court date is set for June. It looks like there is no intent to injure, but just out of frustration. One source told me they would be surprised if he was severely punished by the team or the NBA. After last night's game, he did not address the incident, but he did sum up the season.
Bad things after bad things after bad things just happens to us, and, you know, but, you know, all the praise to my teammates, man, for sticking to all of us. We stuck together throughout all that
adversity. For sure. For sure.
You know, kept fighting, so, I mean, big shout out to those guys.
We will learn more about it tomorrow at their postseason news conference, where the coach and the general manager will speak as well.
All right. Thank you, Maxie. Mm-hmm.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade, Worthless Negro from Virginia, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Friday, April 28, 2023, so I have been told. This is our weekly broadcast, Neutralizing Workplace Racism. Try as best we can, use logic, process things that are happening on the job, minimize problems, work to solve problems without creating new problems, minimize conflict with non-white people, see if we can get all the raises that we can, all the promotions that we can, get hired for the job if folks are looking, keep that job, see that we don't get fired and written up and charged with third-degree assault before we can punch that clock, log out, head home for a hopefully long, productive weekend. The number, no spectating, the number, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Before I give the number out for a second time in the email, number one, I think it was just a few weeks back, maybe a week or so ago, might not have even been that long ago, but I gave out a list of books, and I didn't even try to be exhaustive, books, resources for non-white people. I said, hey, if a non-white person, family member, your daughter, son, niece, nephew, what a neighbor, young cousin, whatever, they come, even be a younger brother, younger sister, they say, hey, black brother, having trouble on my job, you know, white people are getting on my nerves, or black people are calling me coon at work, you know, it could be a lot of things. What resources would you have to share with them? Now, you can share, you know, give your opinion, all that, that's spectacular, awesome, but if they, you know, resources, they want to, you know, try to study the work environment, learn a little bit more so they can be more serious about this. They say, you know, my parents didn't really talk to me about the job, things to do, things to be on the lookout for. Do you know any resources that you would give to your black sister, your black brother, victim of white supremacy? I asked for resources, and I gave my own. I said, hey, so we've talked to lots of folks, right? Gave the book Listen In, had the author as a guest on the program. Gave the book The N-Word Is No Secret in the Service, had the author as a guest on the program. Gave the book Almost British, had the author as a guest on this program. Gave the book Fighting More Than Fires, had the author guest on this program. How to Support and Defend the Constitution for Victims of Racism, had the author as a guest on this program. Like I said, I didn't even try to be exhaustive with this because we've had others, but I mean, that's just some books and things that you could be pointed to that would be helpful. Oh, okay. Think about this. This will give me at least a good start. I said, hey, non-white people, victims of racism, with so give me a movie, TV show, YouTube video that reveals something about this. Oh, man. Labor resources? I mean, like, our priority in terms of what we study, being serious about the problem for all of the folks who have problems on the job. Everybody should have at least one resource for non-white victims or specified as black or otherwise with regards to problems in labor, particular rape, or not, with which they are standard, like, for even, as certain for the world, not to take left down, through the chair, older, younger people, put it that way. Maybe they're in college or something, so they're looking for a summer job of some substance, right? Not just making tater tots or chicken nuggets or whatever, but something that might help them with regards to their career and learning about, you know, how they want to advance in their career, making some steps to get started, get a foot in the door, as they say, for that first nice job, make some real money, that sort of thing. Start filling out their resume. If you have children, or even younger children, right, who are in high school or whatever it is, teenagers, and they just, you know, want to make some money, save up, things that normal young people do, get some money for a school for the fall, or get money to have fun during the summertime. They want to save up maybe to get a vehicle, save up for a business, who knows, overseas trip, anything. Young people aspiring their minds and such. If they want to do that, great. This is a great time to be looking in advance for all of that, maybe even sooner, right? I think I recommended before, hey, see if you can get something that is safe. Now, that's challenging given our system, but safer, right? Maybe the library, something that's air conditioned and relatively safe. If you can look in advance where they can make some nickels, don't have to be working too hard, don't have to be too stressed, don't have to have too much contact with the public, don't have to be shaking people down if they stole a Snickers bar, what have you. I got to chase them for a block and hog time until the enforcement officers get here. I'd rather be a lifeguard, you know. Can chill, sit under the umbrella, holler at some young females, you know, have a good time. Have my friends come, hey, what's up, guy? Talk about what we're going to do for our senior year. That's way more fun than, you know, like making tater tots, chicken nuggets, that sort of thing. Look in advance, and then your young people, as they're looking and trying to find a job and all that good stuff, talk to them about racism on the job. Now, hopefully, if they're 15, 16, 17, whatever it is, they've already heard you speak about this. You all have already had lots of dialogue about this, and, you know, racism is not a strange concept to them. Now, we just make sure we got the workplace component. You've hopefully been talking to them about the things you experience on the job, right? How white people do to you, even non-white people, because that's a big one, too. Your 16-year-old might be the one that pops up on a job and has another black person calling them a nigra or whatever it is. You know, say your daughter's on the job and they decide that they're going to nickname your daughter Felicia. You know, we just had 420. I've been doing the Straight Outta Compton and Friday marathon, so that's on my mind. I'm going to call you Felicia, you know. They say, my name is not Felicia. Well, I'm going to call you Felicia. So your 16-year-old, that they come home with that problem. Say, oh, man, here we go. Dealt with that when your name is not Felicia. You tell them to call them by your name every time. And if they don't, you can give them the strategy. Same thing that we do. You don't have to respond at all. Who are you talking to? My name's not Felicia. You can't be talking to me. Keep on rolling. You can give them lots of different strategies depending on their personality and such. You know your child. But make sure that you talk to them so that they are not stunned. Meaning they end up being on a job, first time out, first job or what have you. Like I said, regardless of what the circumstance is, individuals classified as white, individuals classified as not white, whatever it is, you don't want them showing up on that job and, whoa, what? Whoa, my paycheck is short. They didn't even compensate me for a whole week that I worked. All of those things, tacky abuses that we have experienced, sexual abuse, all of it. Talk to them so that none of that is strange, and then you check in regularly. But yeah, I would not wait till they get the job. This is that probably that time, that season, right? You got young people, they're going out, they're going to get that summer job. Lots of chit-chat. Hopefully you can, like I said, help them find a job that is less rigorous, where they can make some good money, good experience, be air-conditioned, and hey, I got through. I was not abused, I was not raped, and maybe even I got through without being called a nigra. asking a lot, but, you know, we'll see. Let us know if we have attempted parents. Have you talked to your children about the workplace? They're starting out their career. What have you told them? What would you recommend if their parents out there and they have young folks, teens as it were, folks that are just beginning their career, what would you recommend that they be told? I know being on time is a big one for me too. Policy and procedure, make sure you're on time. If you can't be early, be on time. That's a big one too. And then expect the mistreatment. That's a big one. And that would probably be, especially if they're a young person and you haven't talked to them a lot about racism, that's probably a difficult one. You got to expect that. System that we live in, got to expect all kinds, even if you work with all black people, with 8 great grandparents classified as black, born in Georgia, even then, might be calling you a coon all day long. Shouldn't be a shock. Now, get to some of the reports that we heard, and then we'll hear from folks your own situation and or what would you tell non-white children? What have you talked to your own non-white children about? Have they shared back with you about their workplace experience? We got any folks who have teens who are working and, you know, have already had to have some of these conversations about things that have happened to them? I know Ivory's talked to us about this before, too. But we'll see. The reports that we heard, let's see. First up, we heard about Lyft and them, I guess, letting go, laying off, as they want to say, lots of workers. I know we've had lots of people who do rideshare and what have you, or even have done that temporarily. I could easily see that impacting a lot of non-white people and that whole industry in terms of rideshare. I'd say these last 3 years, it has been so much with the efforts to unionize. That's another job in terms of safety. And then the efforts for them to get benefits, resources so that the workers can be taken better care of. Then the gas prices have exploded. It's been so much the pandemic where so many more people were depending on that for a while. And then it's been cut back since more people are back out. And, you know, the COVID thing is supposed to be over technically. It's just been a lot. That right there is one industry of many where I'd say, yes, you want to be aware about things that are happening, your specific company and or the industry in general, pay attention because it is so dynamic and things could be impacting your bottom line, your security on that job each minute that goes by. But that was a big one with folks for doing the Lyft driving or used to maybe doing all of that. We heard the segment about community college credits not transferring. Now, we just had that segment. We were talking about these bogus art institutes where you can go for 2 years or whatever it is, and then, oh man, they swindle you out of all of this money. The same thing, the credits don't transfer, program isn't accredited. No one respects this degree. And in fact, we heard the report. It was a black teacher. They did such a fantastic job, such a crackerjack job educating her. She can't even pass the exam in order to advance in her field. They had to go ahead and move her back to a substitute because they said she was so ignorant and poorly trained, she couldn't pass their exam. Going to these old fake, phony art institutes where the credits don't transfer. And they said those community college, number one, all of that, step back 2 times. When they talk about affirmative action and all of that, this is the sort of thing, keep this in mind too. Step back again, varsity blues, all of that, where the white people, they go and lie, cheat, get all this extra time to take the exam, which we heard in the other report about the firefighters, but anyway, where they go and lie about their GPA, pay so much money, and they get to go to the school of their choice. Remember that one? College of their choice. They got whole documentaries and things about this. Meanwhile, Negros, and they finally said that in that report, low-income students, lots of non-white and black people, they go to the community college, trying to do the best that they can, struggling, working 3, 4, 5 jobs, flipping tater tots while they go and try to get their credits, and then get ready to transfer. Oh, no, we don't. Yeah, you have to take all that over again. wasting more. Same thing that I said with those old bogus art institutes, wasting time, energy, finances. I mean, the financial component is big too. These courses are not free, even if you want a scholarship and what have you. All that money, and then equally all that time. If it's a semester, like, are you serious? We started out in January. If we're on the semester program, I gotta go through May. All those months where I could have been doing anything, even if I did nothing, I could have slept real well. Got 10 hours of sleep every night. What they call it, my beauty rest. I look fantastic this year. Not a wrinkle. I don't even need the Botox. Nah. Did all that work, studying and everything else, and then they like to come and say that we're lazy and shiftless and don't pull yourself up by your bootstraps. Well, dang. I tried to be like Mark Furman. Go to community college, do right, get my credits and transfer, then, oh, no, no, nah, nah, nah. Take all that over again. And they said they got the data. That right there, a whole lot of times will be the difference. Do I finish? I drop out and keep with the tater tots. Not by accident, all by design. Okay, we heard the fire department. As I just said, so we got the two reports. They had the first set, the fire department, where they had black firefighters that said, man, they're cheating. They don't want us on the department practicing racism. They even included the testing company. They didn't just say, man, they're offering services to the white people where they can practice and get right, make sure they ace the exam. They don't offer that to us. Why couldn't they just offer it to everybody, right? The black firefighters, they could have paid too, right? Nah. Nah. I thought they served the community. Didn't they serve that? Haven't we heard this about a billion times? Keep the niggers off the fire department. Incidentally, that's one with the so-called silver tsunami, where you have a lot of older white people who are aging out of these type of jobs, because you can't exactly have 80-year-olds on the fire department. I don't know. I could be wrong. I never had that job, but I don't think retired firefighter. I think that first word is important. Retired. He is not a teenager. Forgive me if I'm outing him if he wanted us to think we're 20, but I don't think he's a teenager. I think that's the job. You want somebody with a little youth. Vitality. Might need some spring in those legs to get up that ladder, you know. Even when they say when the cat gets stuck in the tree, you know. I don't know if I want an 80-year-old have to climb that tree to get, you know, Fluffy down from that high branch. I don't know if I want a 70-year-old doing that. Might want someone a little less age, you know. Just saying. Not ageism. Just saying. But yes, you have these aging white people. Ooh. The non-white people got better fertility rates, so see if you can be a part of that wedge. Maybe we can have a Negro tide come in and take over the fire department. Maybe. Incidentally, so it was two on the fire department. We heard the first one, all the racism to keep the Negroes out. The second one, they had a total fair. They were bringing all these young children in California, white children, Oak Park, bringing them out to the fire department and thinking about this as a career. Do they do that in neighborhoods with black children? Because I didn't see. It didn't look like it was a whole lot of dark children. Like they had old Leroy and, you know, 5-year-old Asada and, you know, 10-year-old Coretta in there. And, hey, we want to come and maybe I could be a firefighter too. Wow, I could be like that old retired firefighter in Florida. Wow, that's a great idea. Nah. One generation of the Opa-locka three is one too many. Nah. Go out and see if we can find some young, pale lads to take over at the fire department. Did you hear that one? Because they said they had folks who had been working in the fire department for 24 years. That is job security. Pension, benefits, chilling. Retire easy, put my feet up and go spend some time fishing off the coast of California, doing it right until I pass the baton on to some white people. Can't have the niggers, Renthal James and such, come in here and mess up the fire department. You got a legacy with this. We heard two news anchors being fired. Don Lemon, I was stunned. I didn't know if the Onion had got me or some fake news type of a thing. Don Lemon is out at CNN? Like, dude, what? Dude, what? I was stymied. You heard in the report, they said the first where Nikki Haley, where he says she's past her prime. I don't know. Is that an old toxic misogynistic black male? I've said that about other politicians. I've said, hey, I think Joe Biden is past his prime. I think Donald Trump is past his prime. I think Hillary Clinton is past her prime. You can't say that anymore? You can't say somebody gets too old. They say LeBron James is past his prime. You can't say that? If it's a female, you're not allowed to say they fire you if you say that? Man, they were going to mandate that Don Lemon go to training. I would like to go to that training as well. So I would know, are you not allowed to say, because people do get old, right? I get old. I just said that with the retired firefighter is past his prime. We wouldn't be saying retired. You do retire. Okay. Gee willikers, my good. I mean, the grandsister, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing. I'm afraid if you pass on, you might be past your prime. Is that not allowed to say? You can't say that. If it's a female, you can't say it, or you're going to be a sexist, misogynist. You're practicing old toxic black patriarchy by saying such a thing. I'm miffed, ladies and gentlemen. If I'm just, old toxic male, which I have been told before, you can just say that and I'll, shut it up. We can move on. But dang. Dang. And then Nikki Haley celebrated. She said, Zena, don't you let anybody tell you, ladies, that you're past your prime. Do you get? They're trying to make Dianne Feinstein retire right now. Aren't they saying she's past her prime? I'm retarded. They said it was other things, too, that old Don Lemon had done, that he had maybe said some other things and, been accused of being misogynist. I don't know if he sent some old text messages and stuff, but, whew, man, got to be careful with what you say. That's why I'm a big fan of. Now, if you have a job like myself where you're required to talk, obviously you can't hush. But, I'm a big fan of not being in the I'm just on the job talking. And let me give you my thoughts on Nikki Haley and old Joe Biden, what I think about the country. You just ask questions. Let other people, let the white people in particular, let them get up and pontificate on the state of the world. And, they can give their state of the union or state of the state, state of the county, whatever they want to offer. Feel free. I'm just going to stay on my job. Now, Tucker Carlson. They said he had a record. He's sending out internal messages. I don't know if these are text messages or emails, both, whatever. But he's sending documented, electronic documentation. You old C-word. Get her fired. All of that. See, that sounds like what my man talks about at the courthouse, that old unjust networking. Sending all these old messages and such, making up a reason to terminate someone's employment just because you got a personal problem with them and that sort of thing. That just, in my view, that is standard white culture. It seems like that is so rampant right up there with the nepotism, right? And the gossip, just sitting around talking bad about people. Let's see if we can get this person fired or pull some prank on this person. Remember, caller at the courthouse, he said that they did so much of this, the unjust networking, even about other white people, that the white woman got mad one time and she grabbed her orange juice and threw it in the other co-worker's face. Remember that one? That's why I said this is just standard culture. I would say, hey, now, you've seen, if even Tucker Carlson can get fired, hey, you do not want to be in the workplace texting, emailing, cursing other co-workers, really anybody, but cursing other co-workers. No cursing is in the 10 stops, by the way. You do not want to be sending out any sort of emails like that, talking about other colleagues and such. Be professional. And I say all the time, especially this era, everybody should have seen enough reports. Text messages that you sent you know, a year ago. It could be text messages from 2011, back when Obama was in the White House, first term Obama even. And somehow, some way, we've drifted 12 years down the road, and that's relevant. And they have to drag you into court. Now, on 2011, in April, did you say that Leroy was a coon and an ape? Did you say that? And Leroy's your cousin. Well, let's put the text message in there, blow it up, put it on the overhead screen. Now they got the big screen, so they'll have the 100-inch screen in the courtroom. Bang! They'll put the text message up, timestamp. Leroy is a coon and an ape. Is that what you texted? On your workplace phone, no less? Is that what you texted? Well, it's been such a long time. And I mean, it's been so many of those embarrassing moments. That was the whole Elizabeth Norton trial. The white woman, she got convicted doing all that lying about the blood technology and what have you, where they pulled out all the text messages, where they're writing back and forth how they're going to do the lying about all this fake bogus technology. Again, you do not want to be saying anything like that. Anything that you write on that email. We've had reports where people got locked out of their email. They do a Don Lemon on you, fire you. Now you can't even go access your email. And it's still on record that you may be held accountable for what you said, what you forwarded, all of it. Same thing I say all the time. You want to speak. Now, hey, Tucker Carlson, they said in the report, he said, hey, I want the world to know that I called her a cunt. That's a white man. Non-white people, victims of racism. You want to be thinking the whole time, everything that I write, it may be transcribed, translated, posted online, nailed up on the courthouse, in fact, for the next 10 years. If I'm not okay with that, and that's what one you got to tell your children, too, because we get in trouble, all that texting and everything and social media, and they become social media friends with somebody that they just met on the job today, and they're messaging and texting back and forth and photos and all that, and wrong. All of that stuff is forever. You really don't want to be saying anything there except things that are related to the job. And anything that you say there before I press send, am I okay with, and I mean everybody, the janitor, the CEO, my supervisor, if I'm a manager, everybody that reports to me, my mother, my children, my nephew, cousin Leroy, I'm okay with everybody seeing what I'm about to press send on. If the answer is even a halfway, let's go ahead, delete, start over. All of that is absurd. All of that, anyway, I would leave that for white people. Racist man, racist woman, apparently they got enough job security, they can do that. They can talk trash about the manager, the CEO, curse everybody out, all that, hang out on the job for 24 years, call us coons, niggers, and all the rest of it, hang out until retirement at 75, cool in the gang. I don't know too many non-white people who are able to do that. And speaking of which, the last one, I wasn't even going to include it, but man, oh man, I have said it the whole time we've had neutralizing workplace racism. Composure. That is the most important thing. If there was going to be any one recommendation or suggestion that should be unanimous, nobody should have a problem with, we can all agree at least on one thing, composure should be it. In the workplace, that is one environment where I've never seen non-white people benefit by just getting angry and yelling at somebody, getting rowdy. I've never seen where that has aided a non-white employee. The final segment, that was Anthony Edwards, victim of racism, professional basketball player. He is now facing third-degree assault charges from two different white women, suspected racists. I had to watch the video about 15 times. He lost the game. Playoff game, season over, white ball games. It happens. He loses the game. He's coming off the court. He's frustrated about the loss. Happens a lot. They have folding chairs seated on the tunnel that exit that you use to exit the basketball court. Mr. Edwards grabs one of these folding chairs and kind of does a circle with the chair, like he's kind of slinging it in a circle, and he kind of throws it to the ground. Now, as he twirls around with this chair, flinging it, one of the legs bops a white woman upside the head, and then it looks like, and I had to watch the video about 15 times, as he's putting the chair on the ground, it looks like it brushes up against another white woman, a different white woman. And these white women are both security for the home basketball team in the arena. They're supposed to secure the tunnel as the players exit, make sure the fans don't get rowdy. You can see the first white woman respond with a chair, bops her upside the head, the leg of it, and then the other one. I didn't really see her respond, but I mean, I guess it looks like it hit her in the video, I guess. The police report, they said there were no serious injuries. It's not like they had to go and get 50 stitches and, you know, had brain damage, couldn't remember their name or anything, just bop, bop, both lived. Okay. Third degree assault, though. Man, as a non-white person, victim of racism, and I say especially a black male, Anthony Edwards, in the workplace, composure cannot be overstated. Now, even in the context of these ball games and what have you, I mean, hey, they allow you to jump up and down and all the rest of it, but even there, hey, third degree assault, you got to go to court and everything. Like, woo, man, I can only say I would have lots of conversations with you. And Anthony Edwards is a young guy. I think he's like 20, 21 years old, very young guy. I don't even think he can legally buy alcohol. There would be lots of conversations. If you get frustrated on the job, I would exit. Exit the building if you need to, because sometimes you just need to release. If you just need to shout, curse, whatever it is, let it out. Then you can, you know, take some breaths, calm down, move forward. Even you might need to throw the chair down. You know, whatever. They have stress balls and things of that nature. For that reason, people have punching bags so they can just let all that frustration out and then move forward, figuring out the most constructive way to proceed. Totally normal. In a work environment, particularly as a black man, Mr. Edwards is a highly melanated black male, it is so easy. You get upset for some, oh my God, he frightened me. I thought he was going to kill and rape everyone here. Especially you slam something. And I mean, it could be anything where you slam something down and a pencil rolls off the desk and bops the pinky toe of a white woman. Oh my God, I thought he was going to stab me, and the pencil almost knocked my leg off. I might have to have my foot amputated, and, you know, all the, I mean, it can just be really exaggerated, and he's got a court date. We went from, you know, let's make summer plans, we're going to have the family reunion, we're going to do the prince reunion, all that. Got my court date for third degree assault against two white women. I for sure will concede I would not want to be bopped upside my head with a chair, even lightly. No, thank you. But dang, third degree assault? Whew. Control your composure, temper in the workplace. It is so easy for black people, especially black males, it is so easy to catch a charge. Third degree assault. In Minnesota, no less. George Floyd rolling over in his grave. Anywho. Number again, I don't know if maybe Anthony Edwards didn't have folks talking to him, you know, Neely Fuller Jr., composure in the workplace. Gotta be calm. Watch that chair. Might crack a white woman's skull, man. You could be lynched for that, man. Too close to St. Joseph. Remember, they have black males who end up in the river in St. Joseph, Minnesota. We just talked about that, right? Anyway, number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. So I did ask about resources other than the ones I've listed already. Resources for non-white people about the workplace. What have you told your children? What would you tell a young person, right? A young non-white person entering the workplace or going to get a summer job? What are things that you would really want to make sure that you've covered with them, that they are not confused about starting out with regards to labor? And then, are you allowed to say prime or past that a female, I guess, specifically? Is that not allowed to say? Or, yeah, if maybe people can help me on that one. Like I said, I've said lots of folks, male and female, are past their prime. I fear I will be past my prime as well at some point. So, you know, happens to the best of it. Do the best you can. Let's see. The email is untiljustice@gmail.com. If you figured out some things that work well on the job, help us solve problems, get those raises and great performance reviews, let us know. If you're having difficulties and would like a logical opinion, see if we can try and figure out ways to help solve problems, let us know. Let's see. Folks who have commentary thoughts to share, *61. And we'll see what folks have to say, especially if we have any parents or attempted parents who have thoughts and what have you. We shall see. Let's see here. All righty. I don't know what you call that, just having a delay in getting the switchboard. The weather stymied me today. It had been winter, and then all of a sudden it went like overnight winter to summer. So I'm getting my adjustment together. All right, people who dialed in with a hand up, if you have commentary to share, proceed.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Our caller in Georgia.
Hello, everyone. I hope you're having the best evening you can have. In terms of resources, I guess if you said this last week, I don't know where I was. I probably fell asleep. I don't know, falling asleep or something. The Occupational Outlook Handbook, I think I recommended that before in general, just let you know kind of almost every job was required. If it's going to be in demand in the future, you know, the pay, the skills, all that kind of stuff. But you, whatever job, you want to know how to do it, you know. Yeah, you need to, the politics, you can get that, but you actually have to know how to do your job in general. Some may not be as complex, you know, I had a summer job at the park, it really wasn't that hard, clean up the park, you know. There's also the Society of Human Resource Management. I think you have to be a member for that. But if you have a teenager or whatever, you can have them join as a student member and it's $50 and you get the access to all the resources. They have sample policy documents, you know, little sections on diversity, blah, blah, you know, all that kind of stuff. I was just looking at it because you asked about it. But sample HR documents so that when if an event they have to communicate to HR, they kind of know the words, the important words that they know so they can hopefully get their issue addressed. So I probably maybe go about it that way. Those are two I just thought of. Well, one, Occupation Outlook Handbook, that's, I've known about that for a while. And when they go on a job, yes, you know, be prepared for mistreatment. So don't prepare to mistreat other people, you know, especially now with there's a lot of division, you know, you may be younger, okay, stereotypically younger, know more about technology, you know, don't be mean about it when you're sharing the technology with, if you have to share the technology or, you know, be valuable in that way. So, yeah, just because you are mistreated, don't mistreat. I know certain, where I work, I know there's a policy and no retaliation policy. Well, where I did work, it was seasonal, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. You know, don't retaliate because you were mistreated. You know, they will get in trouble, that person will get in trouble, but so would you for retaliating. So if there is an issue, please try to address it right then and there. Don't wait, because if you wait and then something happens, it may look like retaliation. So, you know, if you have to address something, try to address it as soon as possible. And I think we talked about with the Fuller said, you know, try to, you know, phrase in a way that, you know, this is not beneficial to the company, whatever. Even the mistreatment, you know, it's not in line with your policies, you know, something like that. And practice your writing, because if you are mistreated, your best bet is to communicate that in writing. So look at sample letters online. I'm sure if you don't have to go through the Society of Human Resource Management for that, I'm sure there's sample letters online to talk about mistreatment, not being mistreated. In most major cities, I think there's a pro bono or free legal group, some community law group that usually helps people who don't have the resources to obtain a lawyer. They will probably have some resources as well, if you can find where that is. So those are the things that last one just came to me. So those are the things that I would talk about to anyone and a young person. The college thing, I don't want to say I can attest to that per se, because I did miss some things out, but my high school was, well, it still is, still exists, is an Ivy League feeder, so mostly white and Asian people. So everyone, you know, 99% of the people go to college, and I'm from New York City, so if they go to a community college, they went to Columbia, you know, that's in the community. It's in New York City. So, but yeah, those things are true. I remember, I think I talked about this before, but when I was a junior in high school, they had a meeting for the parents of the juniors, and I just went because my parents took me, and it was all about how to move the financial aid money around so the kids could qualify for loans or scholarships and things like that, even if they had resources. That was what the whole meeting was about. It was in the evening, and I didn't have resources to move around, so we didn't have to do all that, but that was what the meeting was about. So that is what they are learning. I don't know what they're doing in, just quote unquote low income. I didn't go to that kind of school. I'm sorry, I didn't. My parents, they found out about the school. Well, I think I told about that before. They found out about the school, blah, blah, blah. So I didn't have that particular thing. Now there were some things I missed because, again, there weren't only a lot of black people. And some of the things we just didn't know. Some did, some didn't. You know, if you don't know, you don't even know to ask about it. But all in all, you know, I was set up to go to a traditional university, which I did and graduated and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know. I just know about the money part, and there was a meeting about that. But I can believe the other thing, because we did have a lot of AP classes, and some people, when they did go to college level courses, they were still at a traditional university, a four-year university in the community, and there are a lot of schools in New York City to go to, so someone would go there. What else? Oh, my particular job is over seasonal work, so today was my last official day. As far as I know, I'm invited to go back. I had my end of the season review. I got the target bonus. Just have to figure out how to work a little bit harder to get the max bonus. But I did get the target bonus, which is, you know, what they expect most people to get. So, you know, I'm like most people. You know. We had our end of the season meeting. She started crying, so she's going to miss us and everything. I think she got a lot of problems at home. That was a lot. Like, okay. you know, I'm sorry. Your home life is kind of jacked up, but you make 6 figures. I don't know how mad I'm supposed to be. Bad I'm supposed to be. But she did, as far as we know, you know, when it came to certain situations among managers, you know, she seemed like an advocate for us and, you know, tried to get some of the managers to understand where we were coming from. Like when we had our weekly meeting, she had the managers take over our duties so we could all participate in the meeting. So, you know, she was all right. She was better, way better than I thought she would be. But she seems to have a lot going on at home. And sometimes when people can control something or know one area they do well, like they stick at that. So she is very good at her job, and she's very good at giving us, you know, tools and tips to answer questions and things like that. So, you know, I don't know anybody who really had any serious problems with her, you know. And as far as I know, I'll be going back next season. Again, to me, you know, it's not a hard job per se. I went to school in that particular, for that area, so I was glad to put my degree to use, and I get to stay at home and, you know, I laugh a lot with people. We have a lot of fun. As much fun as you can have at a work at home job. So I like it overall. And, you know, barring some big corporate shakeup, you know, which is outside of my control, I'll be going back next tax season. So, had a couple of weird things. I talked about, you know, the guy being called delicious. You know, she was sharing a lot on last tax day because we kind of worked till 3 o'clock Eastern time. And it was pretty slow. I guess there was an extension in California, so we didn't get a lot of California calls that we would normally get. So it's pretty slow. And that's when I really learned a lot of what was going on in her life. You know, too much for me, but, you know, people overshare. Most of the black people were professional. The only thing was we had a peer review and mine went down. I think I said earlier it was fine. It went down a lot and I was very confused by that. So she went over it with me and I asked her, I said, have you seen anything different? She was like, no, she hasn't seen anything different. So I don't know. People were speculating about why that would happen to people. And I saw mine and there was one that was really, quote unquote, that was, I guess, quote unquote, bad and said disagree. But I guess for whatever reason, you know, people just put in whatever they wanted or whatever. But I was glad I did. It was anonymous and let me do one. So that's another recommendation. If you can do a survey on yourself, do one on yourself and give yourself the best score as possible, which is what I did. I think that's all I have for now. Thank you so much for letting me share and hope everyone continues to have the best evening they can have. Bye-bye.
I love it. I love it. She said if you get a chance to do any sort of self-evaluation that's anonymous, A pluses. Best employee the company's ever had. My goodness. Love it. Love it. If you don't give yourself accolades, sometimes no one will. So, love it. I shared on social media. The Occupational Outlook Handbook is online. So, I shared it. You can share the program And then you can look on Twitter, Facebook, and social media, all the goodies, and you'll see it. In fact, I shared the Occupational Outlook Handbook and the link for the Society of Human Resource Management. So check them out, even for young people. If you, hey, you can send them the link, right, so they'll have it on their phone or what have you, and they can just, oh, okay, keep an eye on it as they're kind of thinking about what they want to do and even summer employment, that sort of thing. Check it out. See what's there. Love it. And even older folks, check it out. Be timely in addressing things. I agree with that as well. Even if you need a moment, if something happens, if you need a few moments, step outside, go to your car, just anything to get away, to process, and then plan what you want to do, how you want to articulate what's happened, keeping the company at the center, where you're not making an allegation or reporting that you have been harmed, but that someone is conducting subversive activity at the company. Someone is harming the company. You are a part of the company. Mr. Fuller gives out a great recommendation with that one. Practice your writing. Now, that's very important. And professional writing, because I think that's very different, right? People are texting all the time and emailing and all the rest of it, but I mean, this is not, you know, lol, rolling on the floor laughing, and STFU, and all the words shouldn't be, right? That is different. Making sure that you don't have a lot of spelling errors, that you have solid punctuation, and that you're using the most accurate terms possible to articulate what's happened. Like what she just said, reminding, they are subverting the company in what they're doing, and or policy and procedure. But practice your writing, especially over the past 3 years or so. There have been a number of like mainstream reports where they've been talking about conflicts at work. She was talking about there can be kind of a age divide. If you've got, you know, folks in their 20s, 30s, and then you've got the silver tsunami, the 50s and 60s and all that. But the technology, where people using technology to talk, right? You were having more people that were having to be on Zoom and texting and all the rest. And they were saying older folks, some of them were very put off by what I just said, STFU and lol and all this and the emojis. And that was causing problems in the workplace. I'd submit, hey, you want to be professional. This is not the time for you to bust out all of the emojis and everything else and all your acronym, text acronyms and all the rest of it. Save that for when you are not on the job, you're talking to your so-called friends or attempted family, all the rest of it. Then you do all that. At work, you want to be, we're talking work. Help minimize some of those problems. But yeah, practice your professional writing for the workplace. Then you can even do some of that with your journal, right? Because that doesn't have to be a book. That's not a thesis. That's just if you're, you know, recording things that, oh, I got my target bonus, you know, boom, you can put that in. It could be some good things to report, right? Got a great review, you know, next time, see if I can do this, change my schedule up so I can get that maximum bonus, you know, and really go wild for summer. Put that in, you know. Put in sharing too much, you know. White woman started weeping. Oh my goodness, what is going on here? TMI. See, save the acronyms for you, family, that type of thing. Even that, I have to. Really, anybody crying in the workplace? I mean, maybe we worked together for, you know, 25 years. Me and retired firefighter, we've been out here swinging off the back of this fire truck, saved some kittens, saved some children, you know, could have died this time, and we're hanging it up, you know, got our watch and hanging up my helmet last time. Maybe, you know, man, we could have died all those years. Remember the time the stripper club almost burned down? All the, you know, okay, get our crowd. But I mean, this is seasonal work. We haven't been working together 25 years. We haven't been working together 10 years. We haven't been working together 5 years. Come on, man. Like, that is just... Same thing. What did I say? Composure. All that. Come on, man. That TMI. Like, get it together. When, what are we supposed to do? Like, oh, Tiffany, it'll be... Come on. Cheer, buck up. Do you want to meet for happy hour? Come on. I'll knit you some mittens. Come on. Are you serious? Come on. You're gainfully employed. You got health insurance. If you need to talk to a counselor, none of us are qualified. Why are you telling us all this? Get it together, man. And they do that old nonsense. Many racial... Delectable Negro, there's a portion that talks about that psychic consumption. Black people's time and energy. That this happens in so many workplaces where they come and moan and cry and wait. And like I said, it's not like we're homies. She didn't say, our caller in Georgia, that this was her homie, this weeping, you know, person on the job. She didn't say that this was her. We've been hanging out, you know, we meet up and go root on the Yellow Jackets at Georgia Tech, you know, cheer on Spelman, you know, ride out the Stone Mountain. She didn't say all that. Ride out the Stone Mountain. She didn't say all that. Catch the MARTA to Galleria Mall. She didn't say all that. Lenox Mall. Sorry, I got confused with Houston. Lenox Mall. She didn't say that. Maybe she's holding out on us. And even if it is, we're in the workplace. You could do that later. You know, you drop her a text like, girl, we got to talk. Oof. What is We're wrapping up. We had a great season. Congratulations, everybody. Keep it professional. Even if it's slow, that doesn't mean, you know, we don't have business today. So, you know, we'll use this time. I can, you know, weep and moan. You know, my child snuck a gun in the school the other day. They're talking about expelling him. I don't know what we're going to do with that junior. He's plucking my nose. Like, what? We do the taxes, man. Like, I don't. Come on. Even if it's non-white person, I submit, keep it, you know, professional, what we're supposed to be doing on the job. Any hoodles, congratulations on the target bonus. Hope you get that max bonus next time. I'm sorry you had to endure all the extra emotion for the last day. Hopefully folks can keep it together a little bit better next time. And great suggestions. Great suggestions. We talked about that Occupational Outlook Handbook before, but always great to get the reminder. It is online. Check and share the program. Much obliged to our caller in Georgia. Let's see. Other folks who dialed in, the number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let us see. Other folks who dialed in, again, attempted parents, things that you make sure to tell your offspring and or would, if you don't have children, that sort of thing. Always important as we head into the summer job months. Let's see.
Greetings, everyone. Go ahead, ma'am.
Are you sure? Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Greetings to everyone. Labor stuff and kids and work and okay, so I do have two. My son, because he participates in the program, I can just always just give him, like, reminders of different things. And because you guys have shared a lot of your workplace experiences with him as he shared his schoolplace experiences, it kind of helps. So if he has quick problems, he can just chime in. As far as what I give him to read and look at, I don't tell him he's not. I noticed that everyone's not readers, and then so I don't refer books. With my son, I'll just, this guy, he's in London, I guess, or England, and English with James. So I totally enjoy him as an accent too. So he talks about a lot of little things, interview stuff, style, how to, what to say, what not to say, different things to do and not to do in the workplace. So just things like that. And I'll send him those videos all the time. And I don't know if it helps or not, but he always watches. And that helps me because it seems like he takes in a lot of the stuff that I state. And then anyone else, I don't know what to tell anyone else, but with my children, that's what I do. And as far as labor stuff, whatever, it depends on the job. Taking a look at the labor laws in whatever state the children, you know, mines are in. Summer jobs. Did mine? Yeah, he did have a little summer jobs, but his jobs were usually towards music and, you know, his little stuff. The music stuff. And now that he's graduating from college, getting into the adult work world, I'll keep doing that thing with the guy in England. I totally like him, and he'll listen. They're not long, lengthy clips. It's just because if it's too much information, it's overload. And if it's in a book, a lot of times people aren't going to read it. So you kind of have to give them something just quick that they can get to and utilize. Something else, I want to click it to college credit. My children were, well, I know my daughter was an avid, the little honors program classes, so that always helps because it kind of prepares them for what they're doing, what they need. It lines them up, and then if you're in tune with what the children are trying to do as they go to college, you can kind of keep up, and they have counselors as well, and they kind of give you a list of what you need to take. With every degree that you're getting, you know what you're supposed to take. So you shouldn't be taking worthless classes because everything is listed, what you need to take in order to get it. I don't understand. So, something else. The fire department. I forgot. Anyway, my workplace racism, just real quick. So full week, one of the days this week, the teachers, neither the para nor the educator was going to be there. I think the Caucasian male instructor wanted to take one of his children for to get tested for autism. The para, the Yemen para, had already had a prior engagement. So she was a little agitated that the teacher had the nerve to take off.
Who was the same day she was?
And I don't understand why she cares. Because it doesn't matter. If none of us come to work, the show must go on. You still have, is that a metaphor? If none of us come to work, the school is still going to run. There's still going to be someone in the classroom to make sure the class has session. Elementary school. So, anyway, she's grumbling about, how did he take off? And he knew I planned this months ago. Why would he take off? And I didn't say anything. I'm just listening to her. So, it went okay. We're still excited. Now, keep in mind, when I say we, I mean the children. We're still excited about when we went to visit the middle school. We're super excited about middle school. We don't know what to do. And we're wondering if I'm going to come and make sure they're okay, too. So we're so excited, right? And now we're realizing that we're in special education class. So some of our excited special education students are wondering, will they be in special education in middle school? Because we don't want to, because we're not retarded like the one that you're here for. We don't boom on ourselves. Well, just those kind of things, even though a lot of them have other issues, like you don't know 3+3, you know, certain things like that, but they don't want to be in special education. So, they're all over the place. You know, I have the one with that gets real angry a lot, and it's complicated because I don't step on anyone's a metaphor, too. So, I don't overstep my boundaries. I don't do too much. I stay in my job description. So, if you say this, that's what you said. He went to the principal's office, the little guy that gets angry, and straight to the principal's office from recess. So we already know he gets angry. He doesn't. Anyway, he got angry. I came outside. I'm not on that angry side of the playground. I'm on the swing side because the pair likes to be on the angry side because I don't know why. So, and when I say angry side, four square, that kind of thing, it's real intense. Soccer is real intense. So the kids are, and then the basketball court is on that side. I'm more soft, top side. So I'm walking by. I was in the class, come out the class, and I see the young man. He's real angry. He's getting mad at something. He's going to go attack. Like, hey, hey, hey. But I don't like to say, hey, hey, hey. And someone else is saying, hey, or talking. So I just stop. So, she's yelling at him, go ahead. Just yelling at him. She already knows that you don't have to treat him like that. So she's yelling at him. So he gets, I just left. I walked away and went back to where I was. So after recess, I went looking for him. He's going straight. So he goes straight to the office. Where's so-and-so? In the principal office. Why? I don't know. He hit seven times twice. Oh, the principal office. He could just chill in here for a bit. I said, okay. I want him to come back to class, but okay. So I go back to class. Well, I don't even have time because I'm mainstreaming another kid, so I don't really have time. So the principal sees me. She's like, why are you not in class? I don't know. He ended up out of class the whole day in the principal's office, totally unnecessary for something that could have been prevented before, but the Yemen lady likes to just push his buttons. And I just left it alone. I didn't say anything. But I did tell the principal I'll try to do little things with him to prevent him, because it's not necessary for him to sit in the principal office. All that is stupid. So Wednesday, the day, major day, no one's going to be there, just me, and who knows who's going to be the substitute. Will she handle it? I had two great subs, and there was two great subs there. Maybe one acted as a pair, who knows, but it was two great subs in me. And we ran it pretty well. Of course, there's always issues at Four Square with anybody in that area because it's a competition game. He had a little moment. One of the kids calmed him down. He calmed down. No big deal. So I thought we made it through the day. I think the little girl may have threw her glasses in the trash or something like that, but we made it through the day. Come Thursday, I say, hey, hi, Miss So-and-so. Go sit down. Hey, da, 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 da. And she also gets upset because when I come in, it's just like, hey, da, 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 da. It's that. So, and I'll pass by her desk to get to mine. So, at recess, she's saying, yeah, I heard you had a hard time in here. Kids drive off, going all crazy. You couldn't handle it. You heard it was rough. Kids fighting and stuff. Yeah, I made them sit on a bench. You know, I told him, no four square for you. Yeah, I told him. And I didn't say one word. I didn't even look at her. I just stood there. Because there's no reason for you to be worried about what happened on Wednesday. Today is Thursday. You're the paraeducator. There's no reason for you to be concerned about anything that happened on Wednesday. You weren't here. Nothing like that happened. I don't know. Yeah, Birdie told me. Somebody had a little spy that told me. Whoever told you anything could have been the little kid that said he just had a problem because you're asking because you want to know how horrible it could have been because you're just that little nightmare like that. So, so I just wasn't saying anything to her because I just thought that was so stupid. Don't chastise. Why are you doing that? So anyway, in the midst of that, the little girl threw her glasses away. Now she's bringing behavior problems into the class because she got in big, God knows what kind of trouble her trouble is. So, now, there's a thing about me keeping up with all the kids' stuff. I keep up with all the kids' stuff because of special education, and they can't remember to keep up with all their stuff. And if I don't keep up with all their stuff, I end up going to help them look for the stuff that I didn't keep up with, so I might as well just keep up with their stuff because it makes my life easier. So we can't find her glasses. I wasn't looking for her glasses because I know where the glasses are. She threw them in the trash. So, she didn't like the Medi-Cal glasses. No one wants free Medi-Cal glasses, okay? So she didn't, so that kind of thing happened. So what I ended up doing was asking, is there a way we can get her a voucher or whatever to get her another pair of glasses and not have her have trouble over the weekend? That worked. Another thing is how I'm able to flow and try to change different decisions when it comes to the kids, because I deal with behavior that bothers the parent as well. So come today, she's the teacher, he's still doing testing and stuff, so she wants to be mean to the kids. No, I won't make them do this while you're at such and such. He said, no, can you just have them do this, and I'll be back in an hour, and then I'll come in and do this. No, we're going to do this. I'm no computers. You know. He said, can you please just do it the way I asked? I have it set up like this for a reason, please. So now we're here at Friday. It was, I'm not in class as often as possible, but I try to be. So we had a smooth day. I got the little boy on a chart because he ended up getting kicked out of the class because he gets excited. So I requested, instead of sending him to the principal office, can we create a weekly chart, give him a reward on Friday. So that's this next Friday. He had his first day today. Woo, went with stars. You have to give him constant reminders to remind him of what he's got to do. We have 4 more days left. On Friday, he'll get In-N-Out Burger meal reward. That's what the treat he wanted, not my thing. But this is how you do stuff if you want to get particular behavior out of children. Work with them and stop all this other stuff. And thank you for taking my call. I'll mute my line.
Play around with sex. The joke is on the offspring. Much obliged, Bay Area mom. She said that with her children, she said her son, who we've heard from, participated here. That is one. I did say, yeah, excluding resources, but that's, I totally forgot. Like, yeah, he has listened and shared. So, yeah, she could just give him things we've said or reminders and such. That's for sure. English with John, I think she said was the other one. She says she shares those videos and checks those out. Seems to watch them when she shares. So that's two. She said he had the music gigs and such, summer jobs. Now that's another one where I said that's way better than tater tots, burgers or whatever for a summer job. Work at the library. Go do, you know, sound system, or if you're going to actually play an instrument. That is way better than, that's why I said, like, if you can find something in advance. I can be air conditioned. If we're going to go and do a concert, that's for sure going to be air conditioned. Ching. At least in the shade. Spectacular. But even then, I would talk to them, because I think he's even shared with us. Like, dang, I went to do the sound equipment and then had to chase these folks around town to get my money. Where have I heard that before? Let's see. We got a live time illustration. Our caller in Georgia just gave us great suggestions for telling folks about the job, young or older. And she said, practice your writing. So important, especially for a work context. Hopefully we don't write the same way that we write if we're talking about whatever we watched on Netflix, or just talking about our plans for the first hot weekend, what we're going to do out at the beach. Hopefully that language is not the same as describing what happened at the business conference at 10 a.m. this morning on a weekday. Practice your writing. In that vein, Bay Area mom, when she was talking, she said, the show must go on. Oh, that is a metaphor. Do ask no metaphors on the program. That would be an example right there. I'm of the opinion, workplace language, there should not be, maybe no metaphors. It certainly shouldn't be every other sentence, metaphor. I mean, we want to be specific. If this is a violation of, I think we had before, they were in the workplace, they had the audacity to talk about safety in the workplace and said, you know, we don't want to get all down in the weeds in this here. I mean, we know what we're talking about.
What? At the safety meeting? Thankfully, we had a victim of racism to speak. What does that mean exactly? How does getting down in the weeds keep us safe? And they had to continue the meeting. Probably called her a coon 15 times. We could have been out watching Netflix. You know, asking, get us damn niggers always got us. Anyway, I'm of the opinion, details, specifics, so critically important for the workplace, especially if we get down to talking about subversive activity and violations of policy and procedure. That is precise. Metaphors. Let's see. The importance of that job description, I think, is important too, because so many times they will have lots of, Mr. Fuller said he called that job creep, where you start out and it'll be, okay, you are to come in at 8 o'clock. You make sure the children are seated, got their academic tasks for the day. They need disciplinary help. You know, you can augment that as well, and boom, 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 help them transition to lunch, whatever it is. And then somehow now it's, well, oh, wait a minute. So at 4, you transition them to dinner, and then you do the transportation. It's like, whoa, wait a minute. That is not in my job description, like, at all. And they just start adding, like, this is what I was hired to do. Now, if things are going to be added, then are we talking additional compensation? Am I getting a new title? Like, what is going on here? So important. They love just dumping stuff on non-white workers. Just take advantage of, exploit, take advantage of, mistreat. And then while you got all these loafing, unqualified white people who get hired because of cronyism and nepotism. Racism. Let's see. She said they got all angry and such. Now, again, you know, if we're going to be eating bad food all the time and watching all kinds of violence and such on all the screens, and then we're in a system of white supremacy racism, that's probably going to produce a lot of violent behavior. That's what's celebrated in the system of white supremacy. Dueling, brain damage, that's guns, bang, bang. Love it. Nothing better. But Foursquare? She said they were getting rowdy about Foursquare. Dang, I will totally put myself on over in the fogey group. Hey, maybe me and Nikki Haley. Maybe we both passed our prime. I did not think Foursquare, I don't think of that as an intense game. I mean, maybe they got a different style of Foursquare in California. But the one I remember, you can't even touch people. You just got the ball and, you know, you're not throwing the ball at people. Like, wow, that is, I don't... Part of me is saying, maybe I need to see what is the intense version of Foursquare. What does that look like? Then I'm thinking, oh, wait a minute, never mind. I've seen black people be aggressive with each other about a ball game. I've seen that my whole life, so maybe I don't. But that did give me pause. Like, wow, that is, I thought, a pretty mild game. I've played many times, had hours of fun with Foursquare. It never got, you know, coon, I'm gonna show you when we get. It never got that serious for Foursquare. Let's see. Man, that whole tacky display, she said, where the coworker, I guess, comes in the day after, so she wasn't even present for whatever happened, good or bad, indifferent even, comes in, and it's, oh, man, I heard about you all are going to pay, and no Foursquare today. You don't even have to worry about that. Get that out of your mind. Come in here acting a fool. And, oh, I heard about it. Part of it sounded like she wanted it to be bad, like it was some sort of reflection on you, talking about Bay Area mom, like, yeah, you don't know how to do nothing. Mm-hmm. Had you in here, they just ran you ragged. That's what I heard. Couldn't control nothing. They just did whatever they wanted to. Oh, I must show them. Oh, worthless coon teacher. It sounded like that's part of it. And then, like, the sadism of it all. Like, these are children who need them. Children, period. You could just leave it there. These are children. Why is that something for me to gloat about, even if they did have a day of tough behavior. I mean, these are students who have challenges, so that might happen from time to time. Why is that something for me to come and gloat about? Oh, I'm going to show you. Even the professionalism. Maybe I could check in with the staff who actually was present, see what their report is. What happened yesterday? How did things go? What's the plan of attack for today? Maybe that, no. No. Oh, okay. Not surprisingly, once again, and how many times she tells us, like, professionalism, the same thing where, at least to me, it seems like the instructors, the people that are in charge, are antagonizing the students, setting them up to fail. They come in and disrupt whatever the normal routine is, or come in accusing them, or just putting them in situations where we're not even talking just baseline learning. It's going to be a total wash. You know, I can go to the principal's office or, you know, whatever else the case is, but this is not going to be a productive, constructive day at all. I'd have been better off, you know, watching YouTube videos, playing video games, you know, whatever. Do all this, you know, I'm going to pay in no fourth grade, do all that yelling at the folks and all of this. I have the young lady who hates her glasses. I guess these are the free ones that you get from the Cal medical program for indigent minors and such. I'm not surprised that these are probably the most hideous spectacles ever. I've heard this type of thing before. I'm just trying to think, like, man, so I wonder how long she has had vision problems, because we've heard this from non-Clemson grad and many, many others, where their black children, boys and girls, need glasses. They don't get that. They're just, oh, God, we got this old unruly Jamal in the back. Oh, Lord, we got Asada cutting a fool. Get to the principal's office. Get out of here. Just get out of here. And then it takes, you know, if they get to the 10th grade or something, like, oh, man, dang, Asada, you've got a stigmatism. We need to get you some glasses. Oh, looky there. You can see that. Wow, that is amazing. Maybe you haven't been a recalcitrant coon all these years. You just needed some glasses. So she finally gets them, and they're hideous. So she doesn't want to wear them. I mean, I'm not a female, but I think for young females, lots of them struggle, right? Beauty is important. Do all that teasing and picking after you and all the rest of it. And so, Jesus Christ, man, I get these glasses, and they're, you know, the worst things ever. I've heard that frequently. Can we at least get her some, you know, tolerance? I'm not saying we got to go get her the Louis Vuitton $2,000 frames, but I mean, dang, something at least tolerable. We can't, is that asking too much? Apparently so. I don't want to say the young fellow, they tossed him out to the principal's office, which happens so frequently. Come in and antagonize them, get them all riled up, and then, that's it. Leroy, get out of here. Go to the principal office. No, you go to the principal's office and hang out there. Couldn't be we figure out, you know, a plan where you could be learning, getting those scores up, and missing out on even more class time. Incidentally, I have seen those reward programs and such set up with students where, you know, we'll go get a meal to In-N-Out Burger, White Castle, whatever. Get ice cream, treats, that type of thing, can be very effective in reminding them so they can stay focused on whatever they're supposed to do, studying, all of that. Once again, the bad food, so many young people, like, generally I would say there's not anything healthy at In-N-Out Burger. They start out, and that's the reward, too, getting something that's really unhealthy, and then we end up with Ozempic and diabetes and all the rest of it. I think it was the Oreo cookies before that they love, and the Lunchables. Like, it's always some bad food that is the reward. I talk about that, how they set those what you crave and the foods that you want to eat that ends up having lifelong patterns for get the salivating, I'm hungry, what do I want to munch up? And then they get me old fries and cheeseburger. And then we got all that hypertension and everything else. So very important. Even what you eat, like that's a component I don't even think we emphasize enough. It's not just you send your child off to these racist teachers and they toss them out in the principal's office and antagonize them through and through and everything else that happens in that environment, but what sort of eating patterns? Because I mean, that's for a lot of folks, that's two meals, right? For a lot of folks, that's breakfast, lunch, and then whatever snacks that they dump on you. They got all those, you know, gummy worms and Go-Gurt and yogurt and Oreo cookies and Lunchables that they get you in between those. For a lot of folks, that's like 2.5 meals for the day. That's, and for what, the first formative 12 years of your life? That is a lot of control to fork over, in addition to everything else from the race. Down in California, they had the case 200 children molested. Play that tomorrow. But I mean, that is a lot to fork over to let someone else have that much control over what's going in your child's mouth. Hope it's just the food for the first 12 formative years of their life. And you just, you know, get to hope it's not bologna sandwiches, Chips Ahoy, In-N-Out Burger, fruit roll-ups. Poison, poison, poison. Just saying, lots to think about before you conceive, get to the bedroom to avoid all of this. Much obliged, Bay Area Mom. Let's see. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-9433. Pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Retired firefighter, thank you for your patience. The email is untiljustice@gmail.com. Retired firefighter.
Greetings, everyone. I missed the report in the beginning of the program about firefighters, but I'm pretty sure it's something that I either experienced or I heard of. You, in your recent talking, you said a mouthful on about three things that I just wrote down to briefly talk about. Eyeglasses. I have witnessed that countless numbers of times where by understanding, well, this child's problem is that they can't see very well. You know, it's something that's right there, but everybody's looking all over the place. And of course, you know, with a black male, he's just a troubled child, just like you said. And then and really the problem is the child cannot see effectively. I have witnessed that over the course of my lifetime. Very important. I don't know what quote unquote neighborhood you grew up in, Gus, but four square games can be violent. And I've witnessed that through my life, my youth lifetime. What's the motivating factor. But the four square game can be pretty stoked up, you know, pretty much stoked up. I'm kind of like joking about it, but I do have some experiences, from that, on my street in Richmond Heights, as well as at the park. Writing, vitally important. The cows participant that mentioned that is on the one. It is vitally important to be able to write and write well, especially because for the most part, you're writing something that's going to be to your benefit, which includes keeping a job. So it is good for you to be able to know how to articulate exactly what happened, how it happened, when it happened, the time, great spelling, that sort of thing. For the most part of my career, you were writing with pen or pencil on paper. Now I think primarily you're typing on a computer at some level of some type, I think. The difference is, although the latter part of my career, you know, the things were going computerized for the most part. Resources for work. As you mentioned, Chief Phillips' book, he was a guest on your program. Correct me if I'm wrong, but he was a guest on your program. His book is a very good book to share with a young person. I don't care what the particular profession the young person ventures to be, go into. His book can be very helpful. I'm trying to remember his name. He came on the program over a decade ago, I believe. Am I correct by saying Ed Reed, I call it a manifesto because it wasn't a book, that he had on racism on the job? That was his name?
I already mentioned that one. So we're not doing repeats. I mentioned Mr. Phillips and how to support the Constitution. So it would be new resources, not things that I've already mentioned.
Okay, did you mention about your own program on workplace racism, recordings of it?
Yes, sir.
Oh, you did? Okay, you got all of them then. Okay. All right. As far as employment is concerned, park and recreations, you know, from the standpoint of if a person is skilled at being a lifeguard, of course. But then again, even in park and recreations, it's not just playing games and whatnot, that sort of thing. They do have periods of time where kids could have access to books. And more than likely, if you're dealing with black children, you're going to be teaching a child how to read, which is vitally important. Teaching a child how to read within that park and recreation job that you have, because they do go to libraries also. And a library, in a lot of cases, to a park, it's not that far away. Being on time, dress code, being in the question mode when you show up to a job. As far as what you're going to be saying, ask questions more so than anything. Maintain your privacy. You establish that from day one, maintaining your privacy. Don't be running your mouth talking about what you did, that sort of thing, or what you're doing. Stick to the employment job itself and progression, as far as progression is concerned, how to make the job better, how to make things safe. Create your own employment code on what you're going to do, what you're not going to do, what you're going to say, what you are going to say. Also, be prepared to have a code when you get called in for some sort of quote-unquote job violation. Be prepared. In a codified manner, you're probably going to have that experience at least once. Keep a journal. That's one thing I learned on the job that I was on. Just about everything that takes place on the fire department is recorded by writing on what they call a log book. They keep these log books. It's connected in whatever that is recorded. By writing, it's also the time, military time. They go by military time. So after 12, whatever, in the afternoon, it turns to 13, whatever, 13, 14, 15, all the way to 24 hours, that sort of time. Do the same thing with yourself. Do the same thing with yourself on the job, on what took place. Now, you know, after a certain time, maybe that particular notebook would expire, and you replace it with something else, another book, that sort of thing, that is quite helpful because you can forget things. You can forget things. And also when you go to a particular meeting concerning yourself and employment, it doesn't have to be a bad thing. It also be for getting promoted or some sort of pay raise. You'll be accurate and you would impress the employers by your accuracy, you know, and what you're saying in that particular meeting. Those are some of the. Oh, as far as a child with employment, I would say, as far as from a professional standpoint, they can get started at 14 years. At 14 years, as far as that concerned, having the responsibility of getting up in the morning or getting up at a particular time or getting ready at a particular time because the job may not be in the morning. Most cases they are in the morning. Being on time, that sort of thing. And so 14 years is a very good time where that can get started with a child from my experiences. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Much obliged. Retired firefighter in Florida. very important recommendation in terms of telling young folks or even older non-white people, as long as we're in the system of racism, white supremacy, it is very likely you are going to be called in, fussed at, accused of some sort of violation of policy, or you did something wrong. That day is going to happen. So be prepared for it. That's another one where I talk about, hey, I'm not stunned about this. You can stay calm, investigate, see, is this an accurate charge? Is there any truth to this? And then, you know, we move from there. That's even another way, even if it is true now, is this something where everybody does this? And I'm just being singled out? Or is this, you know, I'm doing something everybody else knows to do it correctly? And that type of thing. But you'll know how to go through and really pay attention, stay calm, investigate what's happened, ask questions, as was stated, so that you're not totally stunned. Like, oh, yeah, they did say, they do accuse us of cutting a fool in the workplace pretty often, violating something, some sort of misdeed. So be prepared. Same way of thinking. Privacy, meaning I am not just here to talk about everything that I have done in life, everything that I have planned for my summer vacation, all of my family members, dating preferences, how long I've been married, all of my wife's quirks, how many children, like, come on, have some boundaries. And for sure that has to extend to social media and such, where you're not, you know, follow me on IG and especially for, I think, a lot of young people, because they're so steeped in all of that for the worse, I think, generally speaking, where they might feel, you know, a lot more lax about that. And that can just be a recipe for disaster, because these people are not your friends in any sense. They're not your family, even if they're classified as non-white. And you really do not want them snooping through, forward or backward, what you've been posting for the last 5-10 years, or now they keep, you know, bookmark and keep tabs on things that you've posted moving forward in your career. Like, all of that, try to avoid that if you can. You're not there to swap IG and such, unless you have like a professional social media account. If you're going to do, you know, music, photography, oh, okay, you have your professional account and it is used as such for work, with no problem. Follow and share all of my wonderful paintings or pictures that I've posted, you know, the Grand Canyon, all that, great. But if, I mean, this is just you posting news reports and counter-racist material, they don't need to see that. Or even, you know, posting pictures of your family and children and your summer vacation, them to see that either. The writing being echoed, I'll say for myself, one thing that I've noted just with people who write into the cows, untiljustice@gmail.com, many folks are on their cellular phone when they do emails, texts. It's almost 2025, so lots of folks are moving about and what have you. So it's nothing incorrect about that, but there is something that I've noted. Frequently, people who are on a phone, you might be typing with one hand, you might be typing with one finger. And so what I've noted is that frequently, when you do the auto suggest and are typing really fast with one finger or two fingers or whatever on the phone, there will be a lot more typos, grammatical errors with people typing on the phone, just because it's totally different than sitting down and typing. You've got a keyboard. I mean, some folks are very skilled and can type very fast and all of that, very efficient, proficient with all of that typing. But for many people, hey, if you're texting to your friends or what have you, if you misspell a word or every other word or whatever, for the most part, that doesn't matter. They're not grading your text messages as long as they get the joke or whatever it is. What time are we meeting for dinner? Oh, okay, got it. Whatever. But for the job, that is not the case. As retired firefighter just said, you want to be accurate. So if you are going to be using your phone to send messages, I would double check. As I said, this is professional writing. I would double check. Read before you send. Read it aloud before you send. That way you'll get a much better opportunity to catch if there are misspellings or you have the incorrect word or whatever it is. You'll have a much better opportunity to catch that before you send it, especially if you're on your phone. And even if you're, you know, sitting down, you're on a tablet, laptop, whatever, even if that's the case, I would still read, make sure that you're not... The tone of this is professional and serious. This is business. This is not, as I said, writing about a lunch date, coffee time, that sort of thing. Even if this is a business luncheon, business, it should sound like that. Very important. And, being serious with our words. Those words on paper, on a screen, very important. Practice that professional writing. Let's see. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see, that Jimmy Carter's neighbor, our caller in Georgia. Did you have commentary?
Hi. Oh, did anybody else? I already said something. Did somebody else have something to say?
Let's see. I don't know. Correct intentions. Did you have commentary? Or?
Yes. May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the program. Thank you to all the participants of the program as well. I want to comment on the report on the firefighters who were suing because of some kind of discrimination and allowing the white firefighters to gain access to a program where they can test prep for the civil service exam where they can get promotions. I was never aware that there were programs where you could prep for the civil service exam, and maybe some of the other non-white firefighters were not aware of that either. But I think that if that were something that people were aware of, many people would take advantage of it, especially if there were no fee. But if there is a fee for it, it could be balanced out by the what you gain from the promotion. With the in reference to the Lyft CEO, demonstrating cutbacks or demonstrating that maybe they are attempting to find other solutions to gain profitability. I've drive in the rideshare industry, and I certainly have noticed that there's less customers on the Lyft platform, and maybe it's time to diversify if you are a person who is a driver, including myself. I've noticed that it's slowed down in New York City, where I live and drive. There are complaints in terms of some of the other rideshare drivers that there's not enough business, and they've farmed out, basically. I guess maybe not the correct word to use, but they've given other drivers the option to drive whether the Lyft platform or the Uber platform, such as the yellow taxis. They give them the option to take some of those rides, and that is creating a scarcity for the drivers who have exclusively relied on the platforms. One of the issues that I wanted to share was I've taken on the position or contract with a company that takes students from Columbia University to and from wherever their destinations are within a certain area in the upper part of Manhattan. And I've just been taking notice. I couldn't help but notice that the demographics of the students are, there are quite a few non-white students, but very few non-white students who have been classified as black. Out of the 3 weeks that I've been participating with this program, there have been hundreds, maybe 200 students that I've picked up and dropped off. And out of that number, it's been maybe five or six non-white people who are classified as black, and all of those people are female. It just makes me think that you really have to be on your job if you're a student in order to get into some of those higher, more prestigious universities. One of the students was speaking to me about their course of study, which is robotics. And he's gained a master's degree, created programs that are available to be used immediately today. And many of the students are non-white, what they would classify as Southeast Asian or East Asian students. It just it's kind of stark to me that there have been zero non-white black males who I've picked up as students. Not to say that there are no students at that university, but it's been pretty stark that none of those non-white black male students have participated in this program when I picked them up, and there would be no reason for them not to participate in this program. And I also wanted to comment on what I would share with non-white people in regard to workplace racism. I have not been doing a good job of researching other materials to share with non-white black people. So other than this program and Ms. Bull's work, I don't have a resource that I could send a person to that they could gain knowledge of racism in the workplace. And that's all I wanted to share for now. Thank you for allowing me to share. I'll meet you online.
Much obliged. I guess it seemed like there could have been a question there. Retired firefighter, did you know that they have courses available to help civil servants, like they have an exam, or excuse me, they have some sort of exam prep course material that you can take, might be a fee or what have you, that you can take that would help you pass that exam to be a firefighter or to be promoted as a firefighter. Did you know of this? Did they have any such material available when you were working?
For promotion or job entry or both?
Both.
I think it was. I mean, it not was, but is. I think it is. I do know there is a means to study for promotion exams, and there was some information that I didn't know of when I got on, but after being on, I was aware of, made aware of, there was information that you can, someone can, a candidate that wanted to be a firefighter, that they can study for the test. They did have that, yeah. Even back, you know, in the early 80s when I got on. I didn't know anything about it because I didn't care anything about the fire department at the time. I was there. I got there due to a guy that I grew up with who wanted to be a firefighter. And I just took the test without even, you know, doing any type of studying of anything. It was multiple choice tests at the time. But there are means to study for a candidate and for someone who wants to be promoted. Did I answer your question?
Well, it was the correct intentions question, but it sounded like it because that, yeah, sounded, I guess he can tolerate okay. If that didn't clear it up for him, but yeah, I think so. I suspect the black fella who wanted to be a firefighter that you kind of tagged along with, I suspect he probably didn't know about this training material either, which, because you said you didn't know about it, which would not surprise me, that sort of thing, because that's what their lawsuit was about, the firefighters, from the clip that I played. Like, dang, what, how did the white firefighters get the hookup? Which, that's the whole Varsity Blues. I said that. That's the whole, the white people, they cheated, lied about their GPA and college, I mean, high school, what they had done and courses that they had taken and did all these extracurriculars, lied about all of that. And they cheated and got, like, extra time to take the exam. And I think they even sometimes cheated and got somebody else to come and take the exam. Like, I mean, they, every kind of way that you could cheat and lie, they did it and then made up some. And then the black, like, I can't even get the hookup. Like, you might have to pay to take this class. Dang, charge them, right? Make a little money and charge the black. Nah. Don't even, in fact.
Now, that part of it, I'm pretty sure of, that took place with the whites. That I'm pretty sure of. There was one report that I gave on the cows years ago. Disregarding two black males as far as promotion is concerned. The white males had been, quote unquote, cheating on the professional, on the promotional exams for a very long time. They had it, you know, pretty well organized. Somehow two black males were able to get in on it. And what took place, well, according to the rumor, on what took place on how they got discovered, was one of the guys, one of the black male's wives, was mad at him for some reason or another. I mean, really mad at him. And she exposed how he was able to pass the test, you know, to the Dade County authorities, as far as what I was told. And in turn, they fired both of them. The white guys have been doing that. They probably still doing it in some sort of way now, but they definitely was doing that, you know, prior to me being on the job, because I would get it from other non-white black males who was on the job before I was, including Mr. Phillips. He would be able to share something, you know, very accurate on that subject. That's for sure.
Not surprised at all. Lots of lying, master deceivers. I did want to make sure that our correct intentions, where he talked about the demographics of the folks when he does his transportation service for the folks at Columbia, which Ivy League, so-called. I think they're in the book Ebony and Ivy, talking about the different Ivy League schools and how they practiced slavery against people classified as black. But he said that the clientele, it's not tons of folks who are classified as black. I'm so surprised. Al Sharpton's cousins, nephews, Benjamin Crump, nephews, cousins, Yusef Hawkins, family members, relatives, they have not taken over at Columbia. I'm so surprised. I actually have been to Columbia, Ithaca, looking to go to school there, in fact. I was so impressed. We went to their dining hall, and they had cappuccino slushies. Amazing. Doing it up on the campus of Columbia. No Negros doing it up. But I'm not surprised at all. Black, get back. Even still, the individuals who are not white, I am sure they would have some interesting reports of white supremacy, racism, and the folks, especially the refined whites that they are around. In fact, even probably some of the very refined, organized cheating. They do a lot of that at the university level and then just carry that over into the jobs and then add on all the cronyism and nepotism where, you know, we were in the same fraternity, so I got to hire him and all that other nonsense. But long practice, lots of practice for whites and all that deception and such. Let's see. Caller in Georgia, you were going to add something?
Hello?
Yes.
Hi. I guess no one else wants to talk. So, I sent you a link. I found something, again, to the prior caller. I mean, I don't have children. I'm not really around children like that. This requested children, my family. I'm just not close. I'm not around them. So these are just things that I've known, or I just looked up. Like, I just, while this program was on, I looked up a resource, and I sent it to God. So hopefully he'll be able to share it. It was called getmyfuture.org or gov, whatever it was. I don't know. It's in the... Don't listen to this part of the program. Get the link. It has pictures of what's supposed to be, I guess, youngish people and various stages, high school, college, things like that. And it looks like where you can, like a portal to lots of other resources. And one of the things that I thought was very good on there is, like, I need work experience. Because, you know, it can be hard to get a job if you don't have work experience. And they put on there things that they can, that people can use to substitute for work experience. And again, in the email, one of the things I don't think I talked about, but is to be an ear hustler. And just listening, and I mean hustle, because when you get a job, it is a hustle. It is a grind. You are grinding, metaphor or not, but you are grinding the gears in the car to get to the job, whatever. It's serious. If you are in professional circles around professional people, even adults, if they're talking about their job, just listen in. This happened at their job, and, you know, ask questions. Few advantages of not being what is considered, I guess, traditionally beautiful or whatever, is you are kind of invisible. So I've been in places where I've heard things and people just, I'm right there. I mean, I'm not hiding. I mean, you can see me, but they're talking to other people like I'm not there, and they share lots of valuable, they can share lots of valuable information. So, I think I'll put also, if they're young, and they know someone who's a caterer or something like that, when there are professional opportunities to be a waiter, a part of a wait staff, again, you're in that environment. Yes, you're serving the hors d'oeuvres or whatever, but you're trying to get information. So try to get you know, you don't need a great resume, great deal of experience for say to necessarily be a waiter, because sometimes caterers, they don't have a full wait staff, and I don't think you need great experience to be a waiter at one of those particular events. But if you can, try to go to those, work at those events. You may not earn a lot of money, but you'll be around people who may hire people, fire people, you know, government events at the city, and just be a professional ear hustler. And if you're talking to someone, even if they're young, teenager, also, you know, yes, you want them to be the job, but sometimes you may be their competition, and just let them know, I'm your competition. And if they know you, you have this, how can you compete against me to get this job? Because sometimes they're competing, not necessarily with you, it could be with you, but people like you. So to be aware of that as well. Thank you.
Much obliged, our caller in Georgia. I am sharing the link, careeronestop.org. And then they have, you'll see the tabs, Get My Future, for find a career I like, finish high school, get work experience. She already said that one. Write a resume, get a job, get training, work for myself. Just goes on and on. Lots of resources. This looks like what I talked about before, even with writing. And I think she said before, look at writing samples. I think we talked about that before with the COVID situation, the vaccines, and I was saying that individuals classified as white got so serious about that. See what they do when they get serious. They put up whole websites, TikToks, YouTube, you name it, Reddits. Hey, you don't want to take the jab. Forget that, man. They're trying to, you know, put the chip in us and all that, and they're trying to control us. So look here. We got the template. Bam. Here is a sample essay. This violates my right freedom of religious expression. And, you know, I've never taken Tylenol and blah, blah, blah. And right at the head, tons. I'm joking, but I mean total serious. I played some of the news reports where they talked about this, where they had it all written out. And they had it. This was jurisdiction specific. So they had this for like Oregon State, Washington State, North Dakota, Arkansas, like whatever you need, whatever the specific language. And they didn't have a whole lot of lol, STFU. I didn't see any of that. No emojis. Serious. Samples. So important. But they got that too. Sample for whatever you might be doing in a business setting. It can be good to kind of see, and then you can adapt to whatever it is that you're specifically trying to accomplish. Words, very, very important. Anywho, and being informed, I've said this frequently, that's one of the reasons I include the reports at the beginning for workplace racism, just to kind of be aware. I think Correct Intention said he wanted to, you know, look more, find resources for labor. Me too, you know. I think that's really, and I've heard that from many folks where they've said that, dang, I'm not aware. And I can add, there aren't enough resources on labor. I would encourage anybody, I think a young academic, he wrote about his experience as a teacher, write a book. Excellent writer, write a book about that. Anybody, if you on a job, you retired firefighter, that's at least a chapter, right? The Opa-locka 3, that's at least one chapter. 9/11, that's, everybody knows where they were who was alive for that, for 9/11. Like, everybody potentially, even if it's just for you, you know, your own personal memoirs, maybe, you know, you pass it and your child, that might even be something that could be like an heirloom, right? People have passed down Bibles, right? Say this is a family heirloom, and we write, you know, recipes in it, sweet potato pie recipe and all the rest of it. Man, workplace, it could just be codification in general, and you pass that down, but definitely for the workplace in terms of things that are important information that you have learned, resources, strategies that you think are important for the job, privacy, composure, being on time, all of those things, just really important. And again, because it seems, I've heard a lot from folks, parents didn't share anything about racism, and also parents didn't really discuss the workplace and how to function, what to expect, how racism is going to dominate the entire labor experience that you have from whatever job, summer job that you have as a child until the day that you retire. The dominant force is going to be white supremacy, racism. Like, I don't think enough of us catch that either from our parents, I mean, and grandparents and aunties and uncles. Like, man, be talking about the thing. And again, I know that's not cool to be set up and talking about, man, they fired me and got security and threw me out of the office. I had my pictures of my children up and they threw that out too. Crack the frame and everything. That, I mean, who wants to talk about that? But I mean, hey, that is what we had. And the same thing could happen to your child. You should tell them about it in advance. That's why I say, don't even put the pictures up, man. Because they could do the same thing. At least you won't have pictures of your children out, bang, rolling down and slipped in the gutter. Pictures and slipped out the frame and everything. No trinkets in the workplace. Say that all the time. Any hoodles. Let's see.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, I hate to butt in again, but I think we've talked a little bit, well, somewhat about professionalism. I think it's important to know what it is in the environment you're going into. Let's say, for example, I was going to be an accountant for a fashion designer. Okay, I'm an accountant. They're going to expect, you know, a suit. Okay, great. I wear a navy blue suit, but I might put some, you know, fancier buttons on it. So, again, I'm still an accountant, but, you know, okay. You know, she kind of gets what we do. We're a little, you know, we're fashion forward. We, you know, we kind of look for things like that. The language, you know, the language and music may not be the language at a bank. So find out what that is. And especially when you get there, you know, when you get to, there's a general professionalism, you know, I will look that up. Just getting a job, or once you get into that company, when they talk about professionalism, ask them what it is. What does that mean to you in this environment? Find out what that means, you know, because it can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. And you may think you are professional, and someone may think you are not. And, you know, again, knowing the language in that particular field. I mean, they're generally, I would say not cursing, but people curse now. I don't know. So figure out what that is in the environment that you are choosing to enter. That's all. Thank you.
Hey, Mr. Fuller has in the 10 stops, no cursing. I am a fan of that, and especially on the job, because I have noted that, and I think that's been a change over some years now. Because, hey, they have a lot of jobs where they play, like, music with profanity, or sounds, we'll say that. They play sounds with profanity in it that some would call music, but that's been, we've had people dial in about that, where, you know, they've been like, man, you know, I need to do something, because they're coming in and playing all this, you know, so-called rap music. Nigger this and nigger that and nigger this. Like, that's been on many, many jobs for years now at this point. Maybe not at the bank, but I've gone into Whole Foods in Seattle where that's been playing on the loudspeaker throughout the store. So, you know, that's not a surprise at all. I still say, hey, no cursing, just because I've seen where that can get really unprofessional and can easily promote conflict, where just casual profanity when everybody is having a good time and what have you, no big deal. But you catch the one day where people are a little stressed, maybe didn't get enough sleep, whatever the case may be, a little less patient, and the profanity that, whoa. Just my view, if we're professional, let's keep it professional. And even I prefaced all of that with playing N-word, Nigra, in the workplace is so once we've already got that, well, we curse all the time and F this and filth flooring this and F that. Hey, Nigra, but it's, hey, you know, we talk like this. We're just messing around. You know, we say the B word and everything. What do you mean? Now, exactly as she said, now, hey, if this is the culture of where you work at, that's good to know. You work someplace, as she said, where they're doing pinstripe suits, fashion forward. All right, then. Add a little extra, you know, and go out and do my heels and all the rest of it. Great. You work someplace where every other word, some sort of filth flooring, all the rest of it. Most of the time, that creeps, meaning people who did not curse will start cursing. I would say stick to your code because, as I said, I've just seen where that can so easily, some of the worst work environments that I have been in, that was casual. People cursed all the time. And so if that's the way that you talk all the time, imagine what it's going to be when people are a little bit upset. That's what I mean. I would just, you know, but no exact have them and even try to get detail, because that's another one where you could just be asking questions so you know what to expect of an environment. Are they coming in denim every day? Are they coming in, you know, suits, heels every day? Oh, okay. Just so you know what to expect. In the language as well. Professional? Oh, okay, got it. Oh, they're cursing all the time? Oh, okay. They're telling racist jokes every day? Oh, okay. Just, you want to know, what sort of culture am I going into? Hopefully, you'll have access where you can talk to some of these folks. You'll have an idea about that. That, too, is why I said I would want to research. I would want to know as much information as possible about the environment that I'm going into and be on learning. As she said, I am always listening. Learning as people explain this job, this environment, all of that. Even reminded me, Neely Fuller Jr., he said he was talking about being around individuals classified as white who were talking about their jobs and doing that listening and saying it was so drastically different than being around individuals classified as black in this system and what we are conditioned to talk about. I even had that same experience. There was a black person getting ready for the program, and it was a black male, and he had so much detailed information about the Seattle Seahawks and their draft and the people that they were selecting and all the rest of it. It's just like, wow, is this like, if we had that much detailed knowledge about labor and Ozempic, lots of things, we would be in such a better position. Like, man, but Mr. Fuller pointed that out, like to hear individuals classified as white planning, you know, $1 million deals, and or at least how they're going to defraud, you know, somebody out of $10 billion for their, you know, fake company and fake technology and all the rest of it. That's what they're talking about. Man, we looted those old Broncos, boy. I'm so glad we got rid of that Russell Wilson, and boy, we got yeah, ball games. Yes. Let's see, other folks who, oh, I did share the link. Much obliged, our caller in Georgia. Just check the social media, careerone.org. Let's see, our caller at the courthouse should be with us. See if other folks have commentary to share as well.
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Greetings to Gus, the host, the listeners and callers. There's been a couple of things going on this week on the job. I'd like to start out with, there's another white person that is going to quit, and she's going into retirement. So the front counter on the side of the building where I'm at is all white, pretty much. And the person that works at the switchboard is a black female, melanated. So an email went out on Monday where I think the supervisor is practicing racism in the email, because the email went out after the black female assistant manager shared with me that this other black female was going to get the position and that she was going to start training this week, and they have not trained her. So I wanted to read this email that was sent on Monday, April 24, 8:22 a.m. So it says, good morning. Until personnel decides on the front counter position, we are status quo for now. Blank, which is HR, was off Friday and only had a 10-minute interview with the black female earlier in the week, so they are not ready to make a decision yet. And positions are usually open to all employees. Not sure how long the process takes, as our budget is likely to be taken into consideration as a factor. My goal was to get things in place in case there are changes in our department, impacting the switchboard, scanning, redacting, etc. I will let everyone know when there are changes in any shifting and work that needs to be done. Thank you all for your flexibility. So I just think that was a nasty email practicing racism, because that is a contradiction to what the black manager said to me. So it didn't seem like too many people were talking about that. I think another CLIQ member was on vacation, and I don't know if they're trying to save it for her to do an interview, but the way she mentioned a 10-minute interview and things like that, without that person being in the email. So this is the kind of thing that they say, and they have all kinds of nepotism and cronyism that goes on, where they come up with titles, coordinator titles, and they pay them more money. But when a black person looks to be trying to get a position and make an improvement, this is the kind of language that's used, it looks like. I had a few observations. The first was another adoption hearing. That's what I assumed it was, and it's usually on the third floor. It was a whole bunch of white people that came into the lobby, at least about 45 people. I seen balloons, happy birthday on it, and I was headed to the elevator, and I saw a black child, like maybe 4 years old, 3 or 4, and she was just like amazed, like, I never seen this is a black person, like, because all she's surrounded by all white people. Okay, so it was some white children, and then I seen a black female child. So I wanted to share that experience, because those hearings are going on a lot more lately. And that's just, I think was used was abduction, because that is going to be a very harsh, terrible experience for that black child, in my opinion. There was another elevator insult that was shared when, I think it was like on a Wednesday, it was myself, two other people, and a black male bailiff, security guard. He saw another black male that was crossing. He wasn't even getting onto the elevator. He was just walking past as the door was closing. So the guy, the black guy, he says, oh, I want you to go do some work. Go get some work done. Go do some work. You don't like the work. And this constantly repeated that. And so when the door closed and the elevator was going up to the first floor, the guy said, oh, you know what, with blank, you know, you got to shoot him before he shoots you. You got to shoot him first before he shoot you, right? And, you know, that's how he is after all of these years. So now this is a guy in law enforcement, and that's the metaphor he used in relation to another black male. You got to shoot him first before he shoot you. And my last one is I was taking a photo of a black, I'm not a black, but a white teenager, a white girl, and she was with her mom. So I took the photo of the mother first, and then when the daughter went to sit on the stool, and she just gave just a regular, I guess, plain look or whatever. So I took one picture first, and she was trying to say, oh, well, go ahead and smile. What's wrong? What's wrong? Aren't you going to smile? Come on, do a smile for me, please. And she made another comment saying, so this is how you're going to look when you go over there and destroy their country. And so she's smiling after she said that, like, oh, I'm just kidding with you. Don't just care. And then so the teenager starts busting out laughing. So I guess when she saw her with what they call a straight face with no smile, that's the comment that came from that. So I printed the photo out and took it to the counter or whatever, but that was a violent, destructive, I guess, diabolical type comment that she made against a white woman to a younger white female. So those are all the reports I have right now. Thanks for allowing me to share.
Do you know what part of the world they were going to visit, or did they say?
She didn't even say it was like real general, like, is that how you're going to look when you go over there and destroy their country? Their country. So she ain't even really say which country or what. So it was two white people, it was a white woman and a teenage white girl.
Well, that, that says a lot there. They did say that folks are going to get those passports and they are getting out of Dodge. They've been stuck at home for 3 years and they are making up for lost time and going out to destroy and explore their country. Wow, that is, keeping it real. Doesn't sound confused about racism. The no training for the black females, we talk about that all the time. Same thing with the firefighters, the black ones. They didn't get the extra training so they could pass the exam, get the raise, or just pass the general exam. Oh, no. Got to be white for that. Black female, we only got 10 minutes. We got to, got to have closer scrutiny. Negro candidate. Incidentally, I'm compelled to remind folks that we had a white woman. She had a pedicure appointment. Now, I'm not going to say that they, hung out, because, I guess if I'm in the pedicure chair, you want to do a five-hour interview, hey, be getting my toes taken care of for at least an hour and a half. So, they could have talked to her for a good 90 minutes, 2 hours. I don't know. But I do know it was reported that she was getting a pedicure. They talk to the black female. I don't know if it's face-to-face. She at the nail salon. She at the, sauna. I don't know. But 10 minutes is not enough. Yeah. She might have criminal background. I don't know. Maybe she doesn't know how to use the equipment. We need a little bit more time to scrutinize. They even hired white women where they said, and they used the metaphors, you need a little bit of hand-holding, a little rough around the edges, Did you spend 10 minutes with her or an hour? a week doing the interview. I love it. They said, we're going to stick with the status quo. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. System of white supremacy is standard operating procedure, status quo. Call it the meta. We're going to drag our feet hiring this Negro woman. And what I said before, the silver tsunami, white woman is leaving her job. Says it's going to be lots of this. Try to see if you can be one of the black people that is replacing these folks as they age out and retire past their prime. The transracial abduction. Man, it's so much you can observe at the courthouse because they got the archival records of, you know, the deeds where they didn't allow Negroes to own property and all the rest of it, and the racial classification component and the adoptions term, and that even that is connected to termination of parental rights. So, I mean, wow, that is, I mean, I cannot even imagine being a young victim and like, what is going on, Marvin Kaye? What is going on? Man. Abduction. Did lots of programs. Dorothy Roberts, Shattered Bonds in the Archives. Let's see. The elevator insults. I love it. I love it. All the black people are always lazy. Always, even when they're at work, on the job. Lazy, shiftless, good for nothing. That's black people all day long. Now he says all this, black male law enforcement, so much for professionalism. Says the fella, says he looks and says, see, you got to do all that. See, you got to shoot first. I thought when he was about to begin, I thought he was going to say, you got to shoot Leroy to get him to do some work, which is about what he said. He said, you got to shoot him first. See, You let Leroy get rolling, and he'll be in here, and boom, boom, boom. See, you just get on out of here, Leroy. Go do some work. Just get on out of here. See, that's how you handle Leroy. They just sit around, and even, I mean, dang. We got black people that come in and wish death on their children's father. Black people that come in and talk about no count. They even said black person came in and accused him of breaking property at the court. I was like, man, if nothing else, maybe I shouldn't laugh because that's so serious. And I mean, that does cause a lot of problems. We've had people call in and they're very upset about this. Man, that would be a big one. You have got to tell your offspring or anybody, really, you cannot be thinking just because this person has a lot of melanin, is classified as black. Maybe they got 8 great grandparents. All born right here. Good old Georgia, we'll say, or Florida, whatever. Even then, you cannot be thinking, this is my black brother, this is my black sister, and this is a victim of racism. The elevator, and it might be me tomorrow. They better get on out of here. Get to work. What is wrong with you? Around here breaking up these white people. Get on. Why'd they even hire you? That might be me that they're talking to like that tomorrow. It has been me before. I'm not surprised about any of that. Now, I am about being courteous. So, I mean, now, hey, now, if you're not going to talk to these white people like that, hey, come on now. You don't have to talk to me at all. But, I mean, I just got to get lazy and shiftless. Like, really? We could just be quiet. We could just not say a word on the elevator, right? That's what Fuller said. Bing, we press the button and get off. That's fine. Even, in fact, he said the white woman, she looked like, oh, Lord, the coon's got to jump on the apple and leave this. Oh, mad about it. Even hop off the elevator like that. I can't believe this. They left.
Oh, really? Oh, wait, this evening, really?
All of that would be way preferable than insulting other black people, victims of racism, in the way, if minimum, just be professional. I'm not saying that you have to love this person, and that's what I would tell a non-white person, younger person, whatever. It's not about black brother. It's not about black love or anything else. Just be professional. And in this sense, I'm not calling names. I'm not cursing. But I'm also not thinking that this is my friend, that we have some sort of alliance or agreement. We're in this together and the struggle. This is just someone who works here. They were hired. I was hired. Going to try and get through this without having conflict. Be courteous and professional. That's in. Once I see that, like, oh, man, okay. Just going to be professional. I'm not giggling about any of that. I don't have anything to say about all of that. Got to shoot first, you know. Oh, Leroy, you got to shoot. Get off the elevator. Have a good day, sir. Call him by name. Have a good day, Mr. Jackson. Model that as well. I'm not kikiing along with it. I'm not chuckling like, geez. Try your best not to. Even I remember Pamela Evans Harris, Miss, she talked about this, having to see this on her job, where her black coworkers would do the same thing. She even had the misfortune. She said they would do this where white coworkers would come and crack up laughing, just sit and watch and giggle. Entertainment. Just watch the show. Just let it rip. All day long. Just sit there back and forth. Entertainment committee, see? And what's the entertainment? Black people name calling and being in conflict with other black people. All coons look alike to me. Any hoodles, man, we'll be here Saturday, compensatory call in, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. I mentioned the enormous sex abuse scandal in California. Chat about that tomorrow, among many other topics. Passing of Alton Maddox earlier this week, Central Park 5, Tawana Brawley, and then the late Harry Belafonte passed away this week as well. He had a pretty lengthy life, victim of white supremacy, but pretty lengthy life, spent a lot of his time and energy working against the system of white supremacy. But we'll chat about all that tomorrow. Much obliged for folks tuning in. Hope it was worthy of your Friday evening. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, especially our coworkers that we're ready to strangle or they're ready to strangle us. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with other black people. No name calling. That is in the 10 stops. No name calling. Race soldiers, they need us thinking of and calling other black people coons and every nasty name and lazy, shiftless, and all of that is required for a tiny minority to dominate the majority of the non-white people on this planet, known universe. Minimizing conflict with other victims of racism should be a top priority. No name calling and no throwaway offspring. Cal, signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.